Call the meeting of the City Council of City of Palm Beach Gardens to order. Will you please all rise and join me in the pledge? I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Clerk, call the roll, please.
Mayor Jablin.
Here.
Vice Mayor Levy.
Here.
Councilmember Russo. Councilmember Primoroso.
Here.
Councilmember Tinsley.
Here.
For those of you who weren't here last night, we had to carry some of the business of the last night's proceedings over to tonight because we reached our curfew, and we had to do that. So I'm going to be starting with tonight. We are holding quasi-judicial hearings on the following cases. Ordinance 4-2016, first reading, Avenir. Ordinance 14-2015, second reading and adoption, Mary Circle, commercial rezoning. Resolution 65-2015, Mary Circle, commercial rezoning. Resolution 1-2016, Taco Bell site plan amendment. This means that the City Council is required by law to base its decision on the evidence contained in the record of this proceeding, which consists of the testimony at this hearing, the materials which are in the official city file on this application, and any documents presented during this hearing. Council is also required by law to allow cross-examination of any witnesses who testify tonight. Cross-examination may occur after the staff, the applicant, and other participants have made their presentations and will be permitted in the order of the witness's appearance. It is necessary that anyone who testifies at the hearing remain until the conclusion of the hearing in order to be able to respond to any questions. If you plan to testify this evening or wish to offer written comments, please fill out the card and give it to the city clerk. City clerk will now swear in all persons who intend to offer testimony this evening on any of these cases.
Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
First is Ordinance 4-2016 on first reading.
Ordinance 4-2016, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, rezoning certain real property, such property being comprised of 4,763 acres in size, more or less, and located on the north side of North Lake Boulevard, east of Grapeview Boulevard, west of Bay Hill Drive, and south of Beeline Highway, informally known as the Avenir PCD. Providing that this parcel of real property, which is more particularly described herein, shall be rezoned from Plan Development Area, PDA, District to Plan Community Development, PCD, Overlay, with an underlying zoning designation of Mixed Use Development, MXD, District, with a Conservation Preserve Land Overlay of 2,407 acres, providing that the zoning map of the City of Palm Beach Gardens be amended accordingly, providing a conflicts clause and a severability clause, providing an effective date and further purposes.
Thank you. This is a public hearing. I'm going to open the public hearing and ask for ex partes.
Just a point of clarification from the attorney. When did the ex partes start on this? I've been discussing this particular project piece of property for the last 12 years.
They submitted their application formally
from 2013. So it's from the moment that they submitted the application?
That's correct.
Okay, because I have had numerous conversations. I believe I've had at least four meetings with the applicant. I've spoken with probably at least 100 residents on this project. I could not provide you all the names. I don't remember all the conversations. But this has been the most talked about project that I think that since I've been on the city council that I've dealt with. I've talked with other elected officials outside of the city, you know, from other municipalities. Including Jupiter Inlet Colony, the town of Jupiter. I talked to, I believe, Mayor Masters of Riviera Beach once about this. I've had numerous conversations about this project. So I think if I were to actually write this all down, it'd probably take about an hour.
I, too, have ex parte. I have spoken for the last 2 years plus with the owners, agents, consultants, This includes, but not limited to, Rosa, Manny, Danny, Steve Matheson, Ken Tuma, in regards to the numerous concerns that I've had over the last 2 years on this project, as well as the many members of the public.
Mine's going to be easy. The only discussion I had was before the applicant, I guess when he was, before he made the application, I believe it was, when they were considering buying the property. That was the only meeting I've had. I really have tried, and I haven't even spoken to residents about this project, because I always felt that this might wind up in litigation, and with the experience I've had on this property previously, being sued personally in federal court, I decided that it was better to not discuss it with the applicant or the residents. So I was consistent, and so I don't really have any.
Very nice. I can go back into my records and find two specific meetings, October 24th of 2013. As you know me, I like to give dates. May 13th of 2014 with the applicant. Those are my two primary meetings that I had. I have not had meetings afterwards, but certainly as mentioned by the other council members, with regards to emails, staff meetings, presentations, workshops, other items out in the public, meeting and talking to people. So it could be hundreds and hundreds of names and over a 2.5 to 3 year period.
Thank you. I too have had many discussions with many residents. Too numerous to name, actually. But principally, I've been discussing this over the years now with Ken Tuma and Steve Matheson. I have spoken to Rosa and Danny and Manny as well, but not often. My principal contact with the Avenir project has been with Steve Matheson and Ken Tuma. And that's it. Petitioner presentation, please.
Good evening, or I should say, I guess, good morning, right? 11:30 last night.
Yeah.
So, good morning. Ken Tuma with Urban Design Kilday Studios. My address is 610 Clematis Street, West Palm Beach, Florida, and I have been sworn in, Mr. Mayor. A couple items of housekeeping items for this matter tonight, because it is quasi-judicial. I have our whole team's resume that I'd like to have placed in the file. This is our whole team, and they're all out there. I'd request that they'd be placed in the file. Also have a letter from Mr. Martino, a letter of support that he has requested to be placed in the file. So I'll get those added in. Thank you. My presentation tonight will be not 35 minutes, but 5 minutes from last night. So real quick introduction. I'm going to go through these slides very quickly. All the information that contained in here is already in the record and part of your staff report. And I know that staff is going to do a presentation also. So first thing, our team, I didn't get the opportunity last night in honor of time, but we're very fortunate. Mr. Dover is here. Victor has been the primary designer and will continue to design the design standards for this project, specifically on the town center, so it becomes a really neat urban style development within that town center district. And Mr. Dover is very knowledgeable in this area. In fact, he's a John Nolan Award-winning planner and architect. He also has written many books primarily on street design, and Victor is obviously very qualified to be a designer. It's been a great honor for our team to have the opportunity to learn from him and his team that are here tonight. And here's the rest of your team. They're all familiar folks here within the city. Dr. Fishkind is one in primarily who did the economic study. So what is being proposed for Avenir? 2000 of the plan last night, the comprehensive plan text amendment to modify the urban growth boundary was transmitted. The future land use amendment was transmitted. Tonight, the application as before you is a rezoning from the PDA to an MXD with a PCD or planned community district overlay. Also, I believe there is a companion motion for the master, companion resolution for the master plan and design standards, but that's a resolution that you'll do at second reading. So where is Avenir? More for the audience. Obviously, after last night, I think we all know where Avenir is. It's located 6 miles west of the Turnpike. It's identified here. It is 4,763 acres. The surrounding communities are the Acreage, Ibis, Carlton Oaks, Osprey Isles, and here are PJ National, Ballon Isles, Old Palm, and Mirasol. So how does Avenir fit in our community? Well, I had to make a few changes today on these slides, but I'm going to walk through them real quick. So Avenir is now at 0.68 dwelling units per acre, and the surrounding properties and the acreage are 0.8. PGA National is approximately 2.25. Alton is 3.96. So that chart that I showed you last night did a change. So you'll see now Avenir is the lowest density of all the communities identified. Alton, Abacoa, PGA National, Ibis, Osprey, Mirasol, the acreage, and Avenir comes in at 0.68 dwelling units per acre. It's lower density than the acreage. The same program, 51% of the land area will be dedicated to ecological restoration, and 49% is a development area, which consists of Main Street, homes, workplaces, and public spaces. The development program today is 3,000 single-family homes, 250 townhomes, 1.94 million square feet of professional office, 200,000 square feet of medical office, and 400,000 square feet of commercial uses. The 20-acre farm-to-table, a 55-acre park, a 60-acre civic site dedication, 15-acre police annex, and a 15-acre elementary school site. So what does Avenir provide from a transportation benefit? We went through this in detail. I'm going to go through in words tonight. Avenir is agreeing to construct the Avenir Connector Road. That's the north-south road going through the project. It's 4.14 miles going straight as a crow flies from North Lake Boulevard to Beeline. But when you include the loop, it's actually 6.16. That will be built early on in the project. Avenir is dedicating right-of-way for North Lake Boulevard. It's a little bit more than 10 acres along the frontage. It's 2.19 miles. Avenir is agreeing to widen North Lake Boulevard from 4 lanes to 6 lanes from 140th Street to just east of Ibis. We're, as part of this, we'll be entering into a proportionate share agreement with Palm Beach County, where we'll be doing both dollars in roadway construction for approximately $75 million. The way that Avenir is designed with its workplaces, its office, and its spaces, it will hopefully reverse trips on North Lake Boulevard by bringing those services out to the folks in the acreage and out to the surrounding communities of Ibis. We'll be providing a component of workforce housing. There'll be 250 workforce housing units. There'll also be bus stops, multimodal stations, TDM, and park and ride. So what are the design standards? That's really kind of the key component here tonight. And Mr. and the design standards Victor's group has put together are very detailed, and these will become the development zoning regulations for Avenir. So this is the town center district identified here in purple. The town center district has design regulations. The words are on your left, but kind of in more detail. The maximum height will be 4 stories. There are a choice and a menu of many streets in each one of these districts, and this is one choice and one street, but there are a lot of streets. One key thing, though, that I need to remind you, you're approving today is just the backbone. Each and every site plan will come before you for an approval all the way through the project. So this is not, you're not approving anything tonight that you won't see again and have the opportunity to review and comment on. So that town center district is 50 acres. It's up to 400,000 square feet of commercial. There are 250 multifamily homes in there. The way that the design guidelines are set up, they create a perimeter block of about 1,800 feet, and then the blocks have the possibility of expanding up to 3,400 feet. There are sidewalks, 10 to 12-foot sidewalks, 16-foot trees. Also, another requirement that your staff suggested and we agree with, that would be a minimum of 35,000 square foot open space within the town center district. So this is what it could look like. But again, you're going to get the chance to comment on that on the site plan approval. Here's another view of what it could look like. Again, Victor's office prepared these perspectives so we can get an idea of what those design guidelines would allow. The next one is the workplace district, identified in blue on the screen. Again, the words, the regulations are on the left-hand side. These are the details of building heights, lot setbacks, permitted encroachments, and parking standards, which will be consistent with the city's land development regulations. Again, another menu of streets to choose from. The book has significant number of street choices, and as Victor will tell you, the streets are the way for a great design. The site is 220 acres total of workplace. It allows up to 1.94 million square feet of professional office. The building height is up to 4 stories. Again, the same block perimeter, 1,800 linear feet. It'll meet the city's landscaping requirements. There'll be a public green space as part of this. The sidewalks will be 5 to 11 feet in width, depending on where they are. A real vibrant workplace area. A look of what it could look like. Again, these are just pictures. This is not the plan, but we wanted to give you an idea of what would be allowed when we come before you in a site plan. The neighborhood district, the residential areas, everything identified in yellow. Those design standards have a maximum building height, a lot width, lot coverage, very similar to what you did with Brigger. We're setting up those design guidelines, or Alton today, setting up those design guidelines so the future is dictated. Remember, this project's going to be over 20 years, so this book is going to be the design guidelines for now and in the future. So again, a menu of streets, a menu of choices of streets that are available. Up to 3,000 single-family homes. The maximum building height consistent with your code is 3 stories. The maximum block length is 1,800 feet. Lot coverage, setbacks, everything is set up so the design standards for going forward in the future. And here's what it could look like. You'll notice a strong streetscape, the building setback, and the relationships of public and private spaces. Roadway standards. In the packet, you'll notice there are significant detailed roadway standards. The roadway standards here are identified as a 76-foot roadway section. You'll notice that there's a 15-foot buffer on the right-hand side of this drawing. Oops, sorry. And then Avenir's also agreed to donate significant portions of land. The first donation is a 15-acre city annex in police and fire. Second, they've agreed to donate 60 acres for a civic and recreation space. And the third is a 55-acre park. And I forgot to mention, in the residential guidelines, they are required to provide additional parks within each residential community within a quarter mile of each home, within the walking distance. From a planning standpoint, quarter mile is the radius that you want to walk. It's a 5-minute walk. Required to provide a green space or a park within that connection, so you'll have those connections throughout the community. Avenir will also be doing a farm-to-table on a 20-acre parcel of land. Just for identification, it's right here. It's a 20-acre farm-to-table. You will have the opportunity to review that when it comes before us. And also, a 15-acre public school site will be dedicated. Now, from an the other land dedication, and it's a significant land dedication. I know we went through in detail last night, but I have to get this on the record tonight. We've agreed to donate 50 acres of land for a corporate headquarter expansion to the city of Palm Beach Gardens. That 50 acres could potentially accommodate up to 500,000 square feet of corporate office. Again, so Avenir is agreeing, and no one has done this before in the city, has agreed to donate 50 acres of land to the city of Palm Beach Gardens. So we, both our applicant and also the city, can look for a corporate headquarters to relocate to the city of Palm Beach Gardens. So what is the economic impact of Avenir? Very significant. Just a couple slides. This is the economic impact for Avenir. Just so you understand, the value of the tax dollars that come in and the fees minus the expenses in year 2035, Avenir is a net increase of approximately $11 million a year of net revenue to the city every year after 2035. But in the short term, it is not in deficit. It actually generates a net revenue of $200 million over the next 20 years. The construction impact of Avenir is significant. It's $2.5 billion. job creation. Avenir creates a significant amount of employment. The total payroll will be $368 million, supporting 1.5 new jobs per each household within Avenir. It's a 25% increase to the city's total household income. What are the environmental benefits? It is very significant. The environmental benefits in Avenir are huge, and it is really an important part of this project and, frankly, the centerpiece of this project. We hope that the opportunities there where we have ecotourism through the land dedications that are being proposed. The applicant has agreed on many times to make this a really wonderful area. First thing, I'm going to walk through some of the big picture items. So big picture, Avenir right now is privately owned. Located here, it's 4,763 acres. What we want to do is dedicate the north half of the property so the wildlife corridor can continue throughout the property. So when you look at it, it'll make this connection through. And again, here's Avenir in the center of the site, and that's what Avenir does. So the plan, the dedication of that 51% of land allows for that connection of over the 100,000 acres of ecological land. Oops. So here's Avenir with the land dedication allowing all that area to be interconnected. So Avenir, a lot of people have asked me, what's Avenir going to look like? So Avenir is going to look like, well, today, this is what Avenir looks like. On the left-hand side, it's a cattle ranch. It's been a cattle ranch since the 1920s. To the right, if you turn around and look the other way and sweep it, that's what it looks like. In time, when you get the water right, and all the environmentalists in the audience, I know we have a lot of them, will tell you, when you get the water right, this will happen. It's not going to happen day one. It's going to take some time, but it will happen. I want to talk a little bit about the environmental area real quick. First thing, we have met with South Florida Water Management District. It's a very big organization. We've met with the Water Management District, the Army Corps of Engineers. We met with specific people there and their project managers over time working on this. We fully want to participate and want to work with Mecca Farms on the development on the west side. We agree. We want to work with them, work through all those issues with everyone. It is important to note, though, South Florida is a big organization. We've met with certain folks, and we're trying to continue to work our way through. In fact, even here at the city, we had a meeting with the city, the Army Corps of Engineers, and the South Florida Water Management District. Also, last night there was a statement made that I really need to clarify. Avenir is creating 500 acres of new wetlands and also restoring over 1,000 acres of existing wetlands within the project. So I went over this in detail last night, but the land dedication of 2,407 acres increases the city's conservation area, which today is 41%, up to 48%. So in other words, Avenir, with its dedication, will increase the city's conservation area by 7% as a city's land area as a whole. I went quick. I'm a little tired, if you can't tell. So just real quick, a couple things in summary, and I want to make sure I've got all the important facts out on the record. All of the items that we have been submitted to the record, and we are looking forward to answering any questions that you may have. But this is an important project, and I know last night we used the catchphrase, the future, at 11:30 last night, but it really is the future. The vision of this project, the vision of those folks sitting out there, has been great. It's been a tremendous thing, and I hope it will become a great asset to the city, and we look forward to, hopefully, your approval. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. Staff?
Good evening, Mayor, City Council members. Dawn Sonneborn with Planning and Zoning, and I have been sworn in. Just a brief overview. A lot of these slides are going to be repeating what Ken just said, so I want to go through them very quickly so we're not repeating so much. But just an overview, we're going to go over the request, location, the review process, master plan and program, traffic concurrency, and Andrea is here this evening as well as all of our team members, environment, landscaping, water, sewer, and drainage, and schools, and development standards. So the request is to rezone the 4,763 acres from the planned development PDA to mixed-use development district and the planned development district PCD overlay and approval of the master plan and development standards. The MXD land use category requires this project to be rezoned to either PCD or PUD. That's in our comp plan and our code. This is the existing and surrounding area. This is the existing official zoning map that shows the PDA and the conditional use overlay over the entire site right now. This is the proposed zoning map that shows the mixed use district with the PCD, and you can see the little dashed lines or the little dotted lines is the conservation preserved lands. That's the 2,407 acres that's going to be a layer on the official zoning map over all the conservation areas. For the review process, the development review process has gone on since June of 2013. It's been a long haul, and the applicant and the developers have really listened to all the desires and the concerns, and we had a lot of concerns in the very beginning. So these are all the departments that you've seen that have worked very hard with the applicant to bring the plan to what it is today. The review process, as I said, started in 2013, and this is where we are today. The comp plan, the separate comp plan, has to be transmitted to the state. So this ordinance and this rezoning will have to wait until that comes back from the state and then before second reading, which is estimated around March or April, but that's to be determined. Platting and permitting also has to occur after all of that, and then individual site plan approvals. So you will see this project again with all the various site plan approvals that have to go on, reviews and approvals. A location, Ken went into a great deal of detail about where the location is. Background, you heard all of the background last night. So these are just very quick bullets of the background and all the various development proposals that have occurred, been requested on the site. I'll just pass through that quickly because we went into great detail last night. This shows the evolution of all the various site plans. This is how it looked in 2013 with 7,600 residential units. Then the second development plan clustered the development in the south. It was 4,760 units. Last night it was 3,735, and then today we have they have made revisions to be 3,000 units single family and 250 multifamily units, and the rest of the development program that you see here. All the public outreach, we went into detail last night with that as well, but there has been a lot of public outreach since 2013. A lot of coordination meetings internally with all departments, with the federal agencies, the environmental agencies. We had the PSAB workshop in October. This is the overall master plan. As Ken mentioned, there's 180 acres of the land dedication when you include the 50-acre economic development parcel, the 55-acre public park, the 60-acre civic rec center here, and the 15-acre police, fire, and city annex, and then the 50-acre economic development parcel. So 180 acres are being dedicated to the city for these various uses. This is the overall development program. And I'm going to turn it over to Andrea, who will give you a brief discussion on the transportation, the concurrency transportation.
Good evening, Mayor, Council members. My name is Andrea Troutman. I'm a registered professional engineer with Pinder Troutman Consulting and the consultant for the city.
And you've been sworn in, Craig.
Excuse me? Yes, and I have been sworn in. Thank you. We're talking about the second traffic study that had to be done. Last night we talked about the land use study. Now what they had to do for the zoning is a concurrency study, and it is regulated by the Palm Beach County Traffic Performance Standards, and it is reviewed by Palm Beach County Engineering, the Florida Department of Transportation, and Palm Beach Gardens. Mitigation is also provided through this study through proportionate share agreement. And they have received technical certification letters from Palm Beach County dated November 18th and December 10th. And last night we went through some of the key mitigation strategies that were part of the land use amendment. I'll just quickly go through these again. They're limiting their land use to the now 0.688 DUs per acre. They're providing affordable workforce housing, and they're providing commercial uses to be built concurrent with residential uses. And they are also doing some infrastructure improvements that are not necessarily part of concurrency, they're building the Avenir Connector, and then they're widening section of North Lake Boulevard. These will be upfront in the first phases of the project. And in addition to that construction, the estimated prop share contribution is approximately $75 million. They're also providing traffic and transit mitigation. Transit and TDM mitigation. They will coordinate with the city and PalmTran on funding transit to get to the site, building bus stops, bus bays, multimodal center, and doing transportation demand management policies. As part of the transportation concurrency, they have to project traffic out to year 2035, and the result of that is this list of improvements that were identified in their traffic study. The orange links represent links that have to be improved without the Avenir project. So they would fail without any traffic coming from the Avenir project. The Avenir project, the additional green links, are what the Avenir project caused to go over capacity. What this list represents is how the prop share is calculated. It's calculated on every single one of these links, whether or not Avenir had the impact caused the link to go over capacity. So, and it's a very conservative analysis. Last night, several public comments were, why isn't this project capturing more trips on site? Well, the reason for that was it was restricted. The county traffic division and through the methodology agreement said that you cannot, we're not allowing you to capture that much traffic. So they have assigned actually more traffic onto the roadway than potentially could happen. So what we also looked at was how do some of these projections really relate to what the traffic counts. In 2002, the City of Palm Beach Gardens did an area-wide traffic study, and they projected traffic out to 2015. And as you can see from this table, every single link that the projection is over what the count is. Basically, that is what we do. We want the traffic studies to be conservative, and it is a layering of traffic. You take the existing traffic, background growth, committed development. Avenir had to add in the Minto West project, and then they added their own project on top. So it doesn't take into account any diversions of traffic, so it's a conservative analysis. So we wanted you to understand that a lot of these concurrency projections are conservative. And we also looked at APCOA, which was a study that was done in 1994 and projected out to 2015, a 21-year projection. And as you can see, those projections also represented an over-projection when you compare them to the actual counts. As part of the transportation concurrency, a proportionate share agreement will be executed prior to the adoption of the development order. And it's, as we stated, it was estimated at $75 million. As part of that agreement, we'll list priority improvements to improve North Lake Boulevard and other key transportation facilities. The project has been certified by Palm Beach County and has met the technical compliance with the traffic performance standards of Palm Beach County as evidenced in these letters from the county. As far as the driveways along the site, you have 7 driveways along North Lake Boulevard and 1 entry on Beeline Highway. All of the improvements at these driveways, which would include turn lanes, signals, will all be in addition to the mitigation we've already discussed because those are considered on-site improvements. And as part of the transportation, we don't just look at it once and then we're never looking at traffic again. Every 2 years, they have to submit a report stating what traffic is being generated and where they are in the development process. They have to let us know where they are at the proportionate share payments. And they have to develop, each site plan has to show us how the internal roadways work and how the access driveways work. Signal warrant studies will be done, as well as driveway warrant conditions, whether or not they need turn lanes. And a trip generation analysis that will compare the trips to the approved project has to be completed for each site plan approval. And a status of the comprehensive plan mitigation will also be provided. And I'm here to answer any questions after the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Andrea. Oops. The role of technology, I wanted you all just to consider this and keep this in mind. This is a 20-year project, and with all the smart technology, the virtual conference rooms, we've even talked about having possibly a virtual city hall out in Avenir, and how that will affect trips. I know that You might have heard some discussions last night just about the role of technology and what that can, that role that it can play in the future, and how that may impact in a positive way how trips and people are going out and not going out to Avenir. Now I want to talk about the environment. As you know, it's 2,407 acres of conservation lands, over 51% of the project. It's going to be in preservation and restoration, and the applicant has a preservation area management plan that has been submitted. Ken had touched on the critical link that this provides for the whole regional natural resources, and the regulating agencies have all been involved in this review process that you see here, and they will be involved throughout the permitting after all of the rest of this is, the review processes are done. This just shows the NINA map and how the key missing link now is connected with Avenir. And as a part of this process, they did submit an environmental assessment report. You can see all the items here that that touched on. And I had mentioned about the conservation area has four layers. It'll be on the overlay on the zoning map. It'll be on the master plan. It'll be platted. And there'll be also a conservation easement and ultimately deeded to a governmental agency once it's been restored. Ken had touched on the fact that adding this conservation lands to the city, it's would add additional 7%. And right now our comp plan says it's 41%, but I have some exciting news to tell you this evening. I'm also working on the city's evaluation and appraisal report for the comprehensive plan. It has to be updated every 7 years. And through our analysis and our mapping that we're doing, that number is going up to 44%. So if this goes through, the Avenir adding the 7% will bring the city's citywide conservation over 50%, which is very exciting. Landscaping, they have the proposed parkway buffers along North Lake Boulevard, a 90-foot parkway buffer, and by the town center, a 50-foot parkway buffer. And then the required PCD buffers around the Avenir PCD where there are no conservation areas. Water and sewer, I'll just go quickly through this. It is surrounded by water and sewer lines, and water and sewer is going to be provided by SUA through an interlocal agreement with the county. Same with sewer. Preliminary drainage and phasing plan has been submitted and reviewed as part of this process. It has been reviewed by our city engineer. And this is just information on the proposed drainage and how everything's going to work together. The schools have also been involved in this review process. There's an elementary school, two middle schools, and a high school that are serving this area. They have received the separate concurrency approval letter from the school district. They are proposing a 15-acre school site within Avenir, and they'll also have proportionate share mitigation at the elementary and middle school levels as required by the school board. And the development standards, which you'll see in a minute, does provide private schools and schools within their permitted uses as a major conditional use, so that will allow private schools if they're desired here. The development standards, as Ken had mentioned, that this is the framework for the development. It's divided into various districts that you see here, but you will see all of the various site plans come through. A lot of the standards in this, on the development standards that have been submitted, they do mirror our existing code. But again, each and every site plan that has to come through, you'll see all the details further in that these development standards just provide a basic framework. The neighborhood center district is the yellow areas that you see here, and the development standards are all broken down with the neighborhood district standards. Let's just go through this quickly. Town center, the same thing. Development standards are provided as the framework. And then they have different standards for, say, gas stations and drive-throughs. But Victor Dover has been an excellent person to work with, very well-known, and this is providing very good design and smart growth for Avenir. It's the workplace district. And then for the public institutional and farm-to-table, that will follow and mirror our code.
As Ken had mentioned, all of the residential developments will have parks within a quarter mile, which is a walking distance, and all the development standards explaining that are in the development standards booklet. The permitted uses basically reflects and mirrors our existing code, with things like a convenience store with gas station, that's a major conditional use. Things like grocery stores are permitted use, but it reflects and mirrors our code. They have streetscape standards. This is the Avenir Main Collector Road. And then, as Ken had mentioned, they have various district streets guidelines as well. And then architectural standards. The petition has been publicly noticed with the ads and the signs that have been posted. And staff recommends approval of Ordinance 4, 2016.
Thank you. This is a public hearing. I have several cards from last night and some from this evening. I'm going to call last night's first. Some people may or may not be here, but let me call them anyway. Gary R. Alexander? No?
No.
Sal Faso? No. Tim Houlihan? These are all from last night. Richard Wileski? Karen Marcus, I know you are here.
Good evening. I'm Karen Marcus. I have been sworn in. My address is 920 Evergreen Drive, North Palm Beach. I'm here tonight as president of Sustainable Palm Beach County, but also a resident. And by the way, I say Sustainable Palm Beach County, and people are like, and what is that? And it is a not-for-profit that was created about 18 months ago from concerned residents who wanted to look long range at issues like this, where we have opportunities to bring some coalition building, if you will, on big projects like this and that affect the area. I'm here tonight, not the rest of them, because I want to continue, and I appreciate the fact that we're all talking about working with the Water Management District and the integration of this project with Mecca Farms. We have been working with Water Management District and the Army Corps at the planning levels, the science levels. I think Ken's been talking to regulatory, which is the appropriate group. We've been talking to the planning, the guys that are going to build these projects. And they have agreed that it makes sense for all of us to design the Mecca project with Avenir, so the water coming out of the Indian Trails at a Corbett can flow through Mecca and not be stopped there, flow through Avenir, on into the Loxahatchee Slough, through Sweet Bay, and to go up to the Lox River, which is where ultimately we're trying to get it. So I appreciate any work we can do together. The problem is that the timing is now. These folks, if they don't have somebody at the table talking to them, they'll design Mecca without any look at Avenir. So it's really important for all of us to do it right the first time. Certainly cheaper to do it right the first time. So I appreciate whatever support we can get from the city and from the applicant. I know they're doing it right and want to do it right, and we will look forward to working with them. Even encourage the chamber. We'll give them water 101, show them what we have out there, and make this a really good project for everything in the North End. So thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you very much. Next, Lisa Interlandi. Is Lisa here? No? Okay. Kimberly Rothenberg? She was here last night. Are you here tonight again? Okay.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. Kimberly Rothenberg, speaking on behalf of the City of West Palm Beach, opposing the rezoning.
You've been sworn in, correct?
And I have been
Thank
sworn
you.
In. On December 10th, 2015, Palm Beach County issued its traffic performance standards review, stating that the proposed development meets the traffic performance standards of Palm Beach County, subject to 58 conditions. Condition number 7 requires the construction that a contract has been let for the assured construction of State Road 7 from 60th Street to North Lake Boulevard as a four-lane divide. Condition number 23 requires that the property owner make a proportionate share payment of 63.77% for the construction cost of widening North Lake Boulevard from State Road 7 to Beeline Highway as a four-lane, from a four-lane to a six-lane. The City of West Palm Beach is the owner of the Grassy Waters Preserve, which, by the way, is to conservation land that we are concerned about. The property has also been deemed as a pristine remnant of the Everglades. It serves as a drinking water supply for the City of West Palm Beach, the town of Palm Beach, and South Palm Beach. It also serves the businesses and visitors to those areas. It's also home to endangered species. The construction of the extension of State Road 7 takes 57.2 acres of wetlands conservation land and has even a greater impact cumulatively for the area of those species. The city is on record for opposing this project and asks that the documents that were submitted to you last evening for consideration of ordinance number 3 be included in the record for ordinance number 4 as well. The city is not alone in this opposition. There are 3 federal agencies who are on record who are also opposed to the current alignment of State Road 7 extension. Both the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and the United States Fish and Wildlife Service have urged that the current location of this extension be discarded. Recently, the United States Environmental Protection Agency also deemed Grassy Waters Preserve as an aquatic resource of national importance and has indicated that a permit is not approvable. The city stands ready to litigate should a permit be issued. Based on this record, the only thing that's assured is that there will be no extension of State Road 7 from 60th Street to North Lake Boulevard to support this project. The city requests that this request be denied. Thank you.
Thank you. Beth Kegel.
Good evening. Beth Kegel, President and CEO, Northern Palm Beach County Chamber of Commerce, 5520 PGA Boulevard, Suite 200, Palm Beach Gardens, and proud resident of City of Palm Beach Gardens. Actually, tonight I'm back by popular demand, a future of transportation, part two.
And you've been sworn in, correct?
I have been sworn in. Very excited to see the slide and staff's presentation. And last night we talked about the driverless Uber model with vehicles also communicating to infrastructure, which really reduces congestion. Many say will eliminate congestion as well as have many safety benefits. What I really would like to do tonight is put the credibility behind why this is moving so fast and why there's a lot of impetus behind it from our government officials as well as industry. In addition to all the mobility benefits, the biggest driver is safety. Let me give you a statistic that comes from the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, NHTSA. NHTSA anticipates an 80% reduction in non-impaired driver fatalities on the road with automated vehicles. That's a huge number when you consider in 2014 nationwide we were approaching 40,000 fatalities on the road in the country. So that's a big impetus for this. That's why USDOT is behind it, FDOT is behind it, and industry is bought into it. Secretary Fox of the USDOT has a lot he wants to accomplish while he's running that organization. This is one of his major initiatives. In fact, USDOT has actually given up to $17 million to the Tampa area for a project on public roadways for connected vehicles. And actually, let me tell you two of the items out of 6 for that project. One is to reduce morning backup. That has to do with congestion, as well as to improve traffic progression. This is real, and this is happening right here in the state of Florida. On the industry side, many of you read this week, General Motors investing $500 million in Lyft, with the future to be driverless Lyft. General Motors has announced that their 2017 Cadillac CTS will have the wireless technology. It will be equipped for automated vehicles. The Google automated vehicle has been driving around the western part of the U.S. on public roads. And Toyota announced a self-driving Lexus to be on the road in Japan on public roads in 2020. This has really got a lot of momentum. Our state wants to be in the lead of this. FDOT is totally committed and has brought industry, insurance, legal into all this discussion already. So the policy discussion is happening. Senator Jeff Brandis, the head of the Senate Transportation Committee, has been phenomenal in this regard. You're going to see new legislation introduced. He's done a lot of travel all over the country on this. This is real. So I hope you take this into account in the big picture of this project that's going to be going on for 20 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Beth. That's really very exciting stuff. Yes. It really is. You know, for those of you who missed out on Facebook and Apple and on Uber, get involved in a stock move on this one because this is the future, I guarantee you. Next is Bob Freen.
Good evening. My name is Bob Freen. I live at 113 Osceola Lane. I have been sworn in. As many of you know, I've been involved in a lot of the large-scale development that's come to this city since 1980. I've been blessed to be a part of PGA National and Ballin Isles, as well as close to this project, the IBIS development. And my comments really are to the council tonight, not to the public, but I want to commend the council on their very professional and prudent decision-making last evening. It was clear to everybody in attendance that those not in favor of the project spoke about the environment, spoke about traffic, and spoke about density. What was clear to you was that approving this project made those better than disapproving those project and dealing with the resulting lack of restrictions and development on the project. And I urge you to consider approval tonight to let that take the next step forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Rick Ricanus.
Honorable Mayor, City Commissioners, Rick Ricanus. I have been sworn in, and from Tequesta again. I was here last night, and I talked for I don't know how long last night. I'll keep it short today. Again, I want to echo congratulations on last night on a great decision. Your staff has done an absolutely wonderful job for you. I know people are in a hurry now, and everybody wants in a hurry and get the water right and all this other kind of stuff. I would urge you, do it right. Right is better than really fast. Your staff, you guys have been at this project for 3 years, which is a long time, getting it right, and you've gotten it right. You guys have gotten it right. And so keep getting it right. Keep working with your staff. And I think this will be a great crowning gem in North County. Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you, Rick.
Mr. Chair, I'd like the record to note that Mr. Ricanus is a former mayor of West Palm Beach.
He doesn't look that old, no? Yeah. Jack Weir.
Jack Weir, 10258 Alamanda Circle, Palm Beach Gardens, and yes, I've been sworn in. Just a couple things. I wanted to really reiterate something that your traffic consultant said. The closest project in scale to this is Abacoa, and we're now at the end of that 20-year period. And what she determined in her study was that those traffic projections were conservative. They were high, and when Abacoa was built out, they came in lower. So you heard a lot of talk last night about 10 lanes and 12 lanes and flyovers on North Lake Boulevard. It's far from clear that that will happen, and this development group has taken great pains to a higher rate of capture than is reflected in the county numbers because, as she also pointed out, the capture rate is constrained by the county methodology. You wouldn't necessarily know it from last night, but this project meets county traffic performance standards. It has traffic concurrency. And as I did mention last night, if you don't approve this, if it goes back to 400 ranchettes, that traffic concurrency will be used elsewhere. So all the benefits will be lost, but we'll still have the burdens here in Palm Beach Gardens. So there's been a workshop at the Planning and Zoning Board for over 3 hours in October. There was a Planning and Zoning Board meeting for 3 hours plus in December. At the end of that meeting, that body approved this plan 7-0. Last night you topped that. You went over 4 hours to the curfew deadline, and you voted 5-0 for ordinance number 3. So I'd urge you to follow through and approve ordinance number 4. Thank you.
Thank you, Jay. Rick Sartori.
Mayor,
council and city leadership. Rick Sartori, 130 Santa Barbara Way in the city of Palm Beach Gardens, and I have been sworn in. I serve as executive vice president of the Northern Palm Beach County Chamber of Commerce, and as you're aware, Chamber fully supports this. But I'm also speaking to you as a 28-year resident of the city of Palm Beach Gardens. And I think this project and approval of this project is about stewardship. Sitting as a city council, you are the elected stewards of the city's resources. And approval of this project, we approved it and supported it. I personally supported it at a larger number and really think it makes sense at the lower number. But this approval is about the stewardship of the city's resources. Stewardship of the land. The services that we're seeing proposed by and offered by the developer are unheard of, and we won't see them or realize them if this project is not approved as presented, even at a lower number. It's a proper stewardship of the city's time. 2.5 years since application. I think now is the time. It's been through many gyrations and formulas. Now is the time to approve this. Stewardship of the city's talent. You've got an amazing staff here. They did a wonderful job. They do nothing but look out for the best interests of the city to the letter of the law, and I think now is the time to support the stewardship of that talent. You also have the best partner in Landstar and Avenir. It's not the best one that's come along. It's the best one that will ever come along. They are a great partner, and it's the proper stewardship of the talent of not only the staff but also of our development partner and a stewardship of the town's of the city's treasury. You've seen the numbers. Over the next 20 years, over $200 million net revenue to the city. That can be come back to the city in the form of reducing taxes and can continue to improve the services that we offer our great residents. So now is the time to approve this. It's about stewardship. The chamber endorsed this because it meets our mission. Our mission is simple. We are the unified voice of business driving sustainable growth and prosperity. This is smart growth. It's sustainable growth. It's prosperity not only for the city of Palm Beach Gardens, but for all of Northern Palm Beach County, and we appreciate your support and encourage you to support this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rick. D. Sheehan.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, I live at 11544 Villa Vasari Drive in Palm Beach Gardens. I've been a resident here for 3 years. I really believe in this project.
Have you been sworn in, ma'am?
Yes, I have been sworn in. I really believe in this project, and what I see is, quite frankly, I'd like to move there. I see, coming from New England and living in communities throughout my life that have been surrounded by town centers, by a community area, and living and being able to walk, sidewalks, shopping, all the services, at some point, to also be in an environment where you can have medical, everything that is laid out before you in this project, I just think is going to be such an advantage to our town. And I know I live in Mirasol. I love the way our community's been developed. But I also see the need for an option for another alternative, an alternative for those of us that are aging, that would like to be in an environment where we can walk out of our home, go for coffee, have everything that we need right there. I in living on right off of PGA, my entire week is comprised of going up and down Palm Beach, you know, PGA Boulevard. And if in an area like this, I wouldn't be driving that much. My neighbors wouldn't be driving that much. I would be living and enjoying all the amenities that are right there, right outside my door. So I hope you support this. I look forward to, as I said, someday I'd like to move there. I think it's a beautiful project. Good night.
Thank you, Dee. David Aiken.
Hi, I'm Dave Aiken. I'm not currently a resident of Palm Beach Gardens, but as a longtime resident of Palm Beach County, a project of this magnitude has to be well thought out, and I commend the city and the commissioners on the diligence that you guys have done. And I also commend Avenir for the well thought out project that they presented. I will hope that you guys approve this process, and I appreciate your consideration.
And you were sworn in, weren't you, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, thank you.
Joni Elias.
I wasn't sworn in because I wasn't sure whether I was going to speak.
Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Always.
An honest lady.
Joni Elias, 1009 Diamond Head Way, Palm Beach Gardens. I think that it has been said by many people that can say it much better than I can, that this is the best project, and I've seen a lot of them, that this city has ever been offered. I was not here when PGA National was offered to the city, so I can't say anything about that. I live in PGA National. It's a great place to live, and I saw it develop and grow, and I am anxious to see Avenir develop and grow, and I am going to be the last person to buy the last house in Avenir. I will probably be moving from one to the other, but I'm going to buy the last house in Avenir. Vote for it and go for it. And staff and Landstar, you guys really got together for a great project.
Thank you, Joni. You can clap for that. You can clap for that. Okay,
Joni, excuse me, you're going to have to fight me for the last house.
You know, the last house is 20 years away. You realize that.
I'm figuring I'm going to be 88, and Joni will be 78, so we'll be fine.
And the driverless car will take both of you guys out there for a tour. I'll be all set.
Okay, that's the last I have of cards. Anyone else wishing to speak? Now is the time. Then he says no. Okay. Seeing none, I'm going to close the public hearing and bring it back up here for a motion or some questions.
I have a question on the track. The city attorney from West Palm Beach stated that part of the requirements for traffic concurrency was the build-out of State Road 7, which you also said can't be done. What happens if that can't be done? How does that work? Do they still have traffic concurrency? You can both answer.
One of us will answer it.
You're fighting for the microphone.
She'll fill in where I make a mistake. How's that sound? So good evening, and my energy level's up. My coffee's kicked back.
By the way, I want everyone to notice that we raised the height of the microphone between last night and tonight.
Thank you. Yes, sir. So let's just pretend for a second. The way traffic studies work, let's pretend for a second that the Publix that's out there in Ibis expanded today, Mayor Russo, and I'm coming to your answer, they would have to take into account State Road 7. The way that it works, the way that traffic studies work, if it's assured construction, we have to take it into account. We don't have a choice. That's the way the traffic studies work. So and the way the program works, we're required to take it into consideration when we do our traffic study. So if that Publix expands in front of Ibis, it has to take it into account. There's no choice in that matter. We have a minimal amount of traffic that gets diverted to State Road 7. Our concurrency statement or our transportation statement would still hold true if that road didn't get built.
So the bottom line is you still have traffic concurrency. There'll just be more traffic on the road. And, you know, this is the big complication that people have with this whole thing. I mean, it's just amazing. As you see, you know, there's so much traffic, and then, you know, what we showed in the report, that the traffic wasn't all utilized. It's crazy. And you heard last night where I guess this is going to cost $300 million. Somebody made the comment, you know, that I guess, and you guys are only paying $75, but you're not because you're building roads. You know, you're doing other things. And I just think that, unfortunately, you know, everybody relies on traffic concurrency, but there's all different things that go into it that mixes everybody up and so forth. The one thing, and I was going to make this comment later, I had a discussion today with Commissioner Valachet, and I told him I thought it would be a good idea beyond this, you know, going forward in time, that and Sal Faso made the comment of putting neighborhoods together and groups together, which I'd like you to be a part of, so that everybody understands the traffic and understands, you know, what you're dealing with. I mean, you're going to put a lot of traffic on the roads in the next 20 years. But in the next 5 years, you're going to be taking a lot of it off because of that road you're building. And that's the thing that everybody really doesn't understand. And we all know now in 10 years, Beth Kegel's going to be sending us cars to our houses, and we're not going to, you know, it's going to be a whole different, which it is true. All traffic is different going forward. But I think it's very important for everybody to understand and also to see how we can do things differently. I still believe, and Ken, I might as well bring this up, being I have the floor now, that, and I don't know where you're going to, how you're going to build the residential component and so forth, but I would still love to have you think in the back of your mind that you might want to do more professional office if, in fact, the need is there. Remember, you're starting on a 20-year program, and you don't know really. You know right now today, but we don't know 5 and 10 years down the road. I'd like to see you have the ability to expand that. So therefore, when you're doing the residential, I wouldn't want to see you put the residential right next to the professional here, because if you can do professional, you know, additional professional, that's great for economic development, and that's going to be a strong need for that, hopefully, because then we're not going to have enough jobs for people if we don't have professional development. And, you know, in the end, you might wind up coming out because, again, it all relates back to traffic. And if you're going to add more professional development, buildings, you might be able to build that and still build the 3250 in units because you got plenty of traffic because everything's going the other way. This is in fact, our last site. And it's going to be the last amount of flexibility we're going to have with anything because you're not going to be able to create any more economic development sites. And to me, you could also start something out there, okay, that can build upon to whereby there is other land out there, and there's plenty of available traffic trips going that way. And I'd like to see that be, okay, our economic development. And let me tell you something. The one thing I do know is everybody talks about affordable housing and so forth and economic development. The one thing I do know is California, okay, has a very, very high cost of living and a very energetic technology. Okay, we have some of those companies that have come here, like Levitas here in the city, started out in a garage, 15 jobs. I think they have 150, 200 people. Their problem is getting people and getting jobs. I do say this. You know, we talk about the high cost of housing. There are people in California that would give anything to live in Florida, pay the cost of housing, and have a job. Okay, I think that's where we should be concentrating our effort in getting it. But if we're going to try and get companies, we need available space. And when you look at the city of Palm Beach Gardens, I mean, we saw just what happened with United Technologies. A lot of that land has to be there for biotech, true. Okay, and we could put some other stuff on that site, but we need land for economic development. And I said it last night, and I'm going to say it again, and you know what? I may come to council meetings in the future and say it because it's that important. So anyway, let me just be, and I do have the floor, let me just make a couple other comments. You know, congratulations on last night. As Yogi Berra used to say, it's not over till it's over. I advise you to get with West Palm Beach. I know the mayor. I've worked with the mayor, Mayor Moyo, down there. She's very reasonable, very good. I even worked with the predecessor attorney, and she was very good, but she retired. You know, get with them. I ask our staff to do it. You know, we need to, again, we don't really need lawsuits. We need this to go forward, and it's far better to sit down because I think we're all in agreement with what they want, the best thing for North County too. And then the other thing is what former Commissioner Marcus said, you know, let's put that together. That's the right way to do it. I know how hard it is. And again, I don't have to lecture this developer because they know the right thing to do. If it was somebody else, I would tell them, you don't meet with West Palm Beach, you know, you're going to, so just, you know, it's very important to do that. You guys have done a great job. Just maintain the flexibility as it goes forward. I don't think the traffic nightmare is going to be what everybody thinks at certain points, but I do say that we're going to have traffic nightmares, and we got to figure out how to deal with them, and it's with or without you, because I think North Lake Boulevard between the Beeline and Military Trail, I don't know how and ever we're going to fix that, but that's going to be bad with or without you, and I think you help it by creating that other road. So Anyway, those are my comments.
Thank you, Mr. Russo. And also thank you for your years of service and your experience you have invaded on this. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. You're trying to be nice to me so I don't come back and complain.
Right? I didn't want to mention that.
I mean, I might, you know, really, nobody even, I was thinking of stepping down and complain. Nobody even talked against this tonight.
Thank you.
You wore him out last night.
Well, we're worn out, too.
Ken, have you thought about naming the connector road Russo Way?
No. At least you don't want to say memorial like Vito DeFrancisco said. I mean, he wanted to name a memorial tunnel for me. I said, that's okay.
Tunnel? Yeah. In Florida?
No, that's what he wanted. Didn't you hear him that night when he was explaining that? Shady Lakes Drive wanted to build
right,
a tunnel.
That's right, tunnel, yeah.
Remember that? That would be something, though, to have the only tunnel in Florida named after you, though.
Chair, I'll entertain a motion or any other comments?
I do have a couple of questions, you know. The concerns I have are about the environmental area. I have a little bit of a concern about the farm-to-table, which is right next to some very pristine wetlands. Are we going to have any bans on pesticides and fertilizers on that farm-to-table? How are we going to augment soil to make sure that that grows well? Or capture water runoff that's coming off of that to make sure it doesn't go into that wetland area?
Well, number one, the farm-to-table agricultural use is actually not being approved tonight. Okay. It's being delineated on the plan, but there's a condition of approval in the resolution that requires the applicant to come through an entire separately new major conditional use approval consistent with our code, which requires that for all agricultural uses. So we will have the opportunity to vet the entire proposed agricultural operation through that process. In addition, in the resolution, are a number of conditions that are standard South Florida water management conditions dealing with nitrates and pesticides, and those will also all be included right from the get-go, right in Resolution 4.
And phosphates will be included in that too, okay. On the planting palette, the planting palette, sorry, Marcy, I hope I'm not taking, you know, we have to be very careful about what we plant out there because I think we want to use low water, more native species and species that don't require a lot of pesticides and fertilizers. This project, I guess this is where I'm getting to, this project is sitting right in the middle of some very important environmentally sensitive lands. The state of Florida is traditionally low in phosphorus and nitrogen. Of course, pesticides usually don't occur naturally. We need to be very careful that we don't allow these discharges and cause algae blooms and other bad things that are going to occur into some of these environmentally sensitive lands. And the time to actually start planning that and thinking about that is now. And the species that we allow to be planted there, and there are some beautiful native species, is going to be very important to these ecological areas. And also, you know, as a member of the Loxachie River Management Coordinating Council, also a member and a former chairman of the Water Resource Task Force, water quality is going to be critical, and what we do now and as the designs and going forward and thinking about both stormwater drainage and where we're going to take water and put water and how we treat it needs to be thought of before we start doing a lot of the planning, because putting this infrastructure in afterwards would be very difficult, which brings me to the last set of questions, and that's about stormwater drainage. I assume that this is going to be designed to capture, I believe it's 1 inch of rain in a 24-hour period of time. Should we get Hurricane Isaac out there? As you know, when we had Hurricane Isaac, we had some major flooding in both Corbett and Isaac, our Corbett wildlife and the acreage, where the district had to drain off water very rapidly down the C-17 and C-18 canal, which caused us a lot of problems to the east. Some flooding and steeplechase occurred because of that. And also we had a brown grunge for a couple of months at the beach areas because of the turbidity located in the C-18 canal, which eventually discharged the Jupiter Inlet. The stormwater is very, very important. I want to be able, of course, capture the minimum, maybe some additional. And I'm hoping that this project would be able to take excess water out of Corbett and the acreage, if need be, and store that until it can be more rationally discharged down the C-18 and C-17 canals. So I'm hoping that we do that type of drainage. And I think you probably already have that plan. When I originally talked to you years ago when you were thinking about buying this plan, I said that was one of my conditions for approval. So at second reading, I would like to have some of that discussed, you know, what we're going to do there, because we are creating impervious surface over half of the property, and I want to be able to make sure that we, and I saw the kind of preliminary drainage plan, it looked like it was adequate with drainage ponds and things along those lines. And also we need to think about, we have a Hurricane Isaac, we have that 100-year storm. What are we going to do? Where's your outfalls going to be, and how are we going to manage that for the regional flood area? So while you're coordinating with Karen Marcus and the South Florida Water Management District, and I'm sure that they're going to require you to coordinate with the other areas, this could be a very important puzzle to not just store water, but also to prevent flooding both out there and also here in the center part of our city, because the floodwater drainage, you know, I'm going to quote Governor Broward here from 1904. His campaign slogan is, "Water flows downhill."
Yeah, that's why we need a scientist like David on this council.
Geologist.
Well, he's a scientist. A scientist, yes. Okay, Bert, you want to say something?
Yeah, the only things I really want to talk about are with regards to the uniqueness of the project. I mean, when you put up the financial numbers on there, I mean, everybody gets excited, obviously, for what the impact of our city will look like in 20 years from a financial standpoint. And being the budget guy, I really enjoy those numbers. But as I look at this project, you know, I'm just thoroughly impressed with regards to density levels and conservation. And staff will tell you, when I had my original meetings a couple years ago, I always kind of envisioned Mirasol as a kind of the model project in terms of density conservation, how it looked. And I know we had a speaker from there tonight, and I always loved that project. And as I see these numbers now, even lower in terms of density, the size of the conservation space of this property being allocated to our city, and what it's going to look like, I think it is really a unique and a model community that you're not going to see around here in this state and really in this area at all. So I think it's a beautiful project. I'm not a lander, planner, designer, grower, vegetable guy, scientist. I don't understand any of that stuff, frankly. But when I look at this project, I mean, how can you not be impressed? I mean, you have to be impressed of what they've done, the time they put into it. We had a project that we approved, I think, late last year, where the applicant has been in here for 2 years working on the project to get approved. These guys are closer to three. So we don't just give in to every request that comes in the city. We just don't approve everything that comes here on the first whim. I mean, we are considering really the whole view and the whole approach of the city on how we want to do business and how we want it to look. So I'm really impressed of the last project, of how it came out. I would think it's going to get done tonight. We'll hear from everybody else. And I agree wholeheartedly with Mr. Sartori when he talks about stewardship. And we expect that out of you guys as this project moves forward. And as Councilman Russo said, communicating with the neighbors and the other municipalities and other people in the area, that communication is critical. We've always demanded that of projects in our city. And that as this moves forward, we expect to hear good things, and that you're a good player, a good neighbor, and a good communicator. So good luck on your project.
Thanks, Bert. Marcy?
Okay, I'm going to start out with just a quick question, and I think Andrea mentioned a two-year traffic monitoring program. Is that a monitoring program that's done through the county or done through the city?
It's a city requirement.
Oh, okay, got it. And thank you, I appreciate that. That was it for my questions. Shocking, right? I do want to just say a few things. I know I spoke a lot last night, so I'm going to try to make it very quick and painless. But this, as I said last night, is one of the most unique properties in our city. It's the largest, as we all have mentioned, and it can be a real gem if it's done well and if we all work together to make that happen. And I think we can. I really do. When it first was proposed, I was absolutely opposed to it because of the size. But to think 0.6 dwelling units per acre, wow, we've really come a long way with all of the
amenities that we just spoke about, it's going to be a great project. So I'm really looking forward to working with all of you for at least the next year. But if I'm not here in the dais, I'll be right on the other side, believe me. It's our obligation to plan for the future, which we all have said, for this city, and to be forward thinkers. And this development can provide that and go a long way to help in that regard. I do want to say, Joe, you actually brought up a really good point last night, and that was in regards to the trip capture rate and that phasing schedule. The phasing schedule, which you hit the nail right on the head, you have the residential and you have all of those non-residential uses all in the first phase, and that's very important. And we talked about trip capture, and we talked about the conservative nature of that. And that spine road, the road that goes north-south, whatever the name of that will be, that is going to be a major reliever for Beeline and North Lake Boulevard. And that's one thing that I really want to mention because it's really important. And traffic is, you know, we talked about prop share, we talked about all of that, but traffic is very counterintuitive. And as Bert said last night with State Road 7, if that was constructed, then some of the intersections along North Lake Boulevard wouldn't be as congested because of that roadway. I understand the controversial nature of that road, but that's just the way it is. If it were there, which it was planned many, many, many years ago, we wouldn't have as many of those issues on North Lake Boulevard. So we have to be forward thinkers, think out of the box in how we can mitigate it. And land use is one of those ways to mitigate it. Karen brought up a very good point last night, which is to work together. That's something that the city has always said on many projects, and I encourage you to do that. I think it's a great idea. It's a great project to have it go from Mecca, to work cooperatively with all of that. And I know you guys will, because you're in it for the long run. So I just want to encourage you to do that. But like I said last night, this is an environmental home run, and there's nothing else to say about that in regards to the conservation area. We talked about the timing and the dedication, so I'm not going to go into that, but I did read all 561 pages, including the design guidelines, and reviewed all of the cross sections. I know this is the rezoning. I know we have many other bites at this apple, but it's a big apple, and so I want to make sure that when you move forward, that 76-foot right-of-way, the landscape buffers, and I'm just saying this because I learned from Brigger. I drive by Brigger every single day, as do you, on the way home and my daily business. When we went through, and let me just put this out there, Brigger was approved when I was not here. However, I have had an opportunity to review a lot of the site plans and to go through some of the approvals for that. And I've been, or we have looked at some of the buffers, and as you know, we've had some discussions in regards to utility easements and landscape buffers after the fact, because we all know FPNL and Seacoast does not let any landscaping or like any landscaping in their easements. So I don't want to have somebody come up here later and ask for waivers. I'm just throwing this out there right now. That 76-foot right-of-way has a 20-foot landscape buffer and a 35-foot landscape buffer easement, or whatever you're calling it. I checked out the section that is inundated fully with Seacoast utilities, light poles, and FPNL easements. I don't want that to happen. I want to make sure our landscape buffers are free and clear of easements. Just throwing that out there for the future. I know you'll work with me on that as we go forward in the future. Also, there's some inconsistencies with the 90-foot sections. I just want to make sure that we take a look at that as we move forward. Okay? Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Good. Very good. Very good. You're going to be quick for items by council, too?
Yeah.
Or you have a whole list? We don't have too much time, so I'm not going to make a big speech, but I just want to say this. You know, I've served up here 24 years. And you're looking at one of the best councils this city has ever had. You really are. And you want to clap? Go ahead. I work with a lot of people up here. Joe and I have been here together for a long time, and it's kind of apropos that we're here for the largest and the last major piece of land to be developed in the city. And it's just amazing. It's gone by so quickly. But, you know, this city looks so much different than when I first moved here. And as I talk to people out there off this council, they all tell me what a wonderful city it is and how lucky they are to live here. Rick, you're smiling. Yeah. You know, Rick ran against me years ago. I beat him. But I think he's – I don't think he's happy. I know he's happy about
you
that.
You beat him, but he won.
He won. But I don't want to wax too sentimental, but it is interesting that the two of us have been up here the longest, and we've seen almost every major development come out of the ground, the two of us. And so this is one of your last meetings, not your last, but I'm going to be missing you next year when we you won't be here after March, when we finally approve this. But I hope you're in the audience, because I hope we can bring you back up here just for a ceremonial vote, okay?
I might be here because I might fill out a comment card.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that because it's been a great trip, a grand trip, and I'm so privileged to have been part of it. Thank you for everything, Ken, Steve, Rosa, Manny, Danny, all of you guys. You've been terrific. You've been wonderful to work with, and I know that you'll be wonderful to work with in the future, because I know that you are very civic-minded and you care about this city as much as we do. You've become citizens here, which is really nice. Okay? Okay, now we're going to move on with the rest of them. Oh, wait, we got a vote. I'm sorry. I almost blew the whole thing. Chair will entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I'll make a motion to approve ordinance 4-2016.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor? Aye. Passes 5-0.
Very quickly, on behalf of Olive Avenue, Mr. Mayor, thank you very much. And the whole team is here and the family's here. We appreciate your time. Thank
We're
you.
We're going to just take a 5-minute recess in between, because I know some of the people from Avenue want to leave, and the rest of the meeting will re-adjourn in 5 minutes. Thank you. Okay, next is additions, deletions, and modifications, and I'd like to make one modification, please. I'd like to move item G in public hearings up to the beginning. That's the let me just reference it correctly. Resolution 9-2016, and that's the body-worn cameras. If we could have a motion, please.
Motion to reorder the agenda.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Passes 5-0. Before 14, yes, correct. Okay. Resuming the agenda, we have announcements and presentations. The Honda Classic, Charlotte.
Good evening, Council. Charlotte Przenski, Project Director, for the record. It's that time of the year. The Honda Classic is about 45 days away. You know it's going to be held February 22nd through the 28th at PGA National Resort. It has been in our city since 2005, and as you also know, the Honda Classic and their related charity effort, Honda Cares, has been an integral part and a great partner with our city. And to tell you more about that and what the Honda Classic brings to our community, I'd like to introduce Ken Kennerly, the Executive Director of the Classic.
Thank you, Charlotte. Mr. Mayor, City Council members, thank you for having us this evening. Andrew George, standing next to me, our Tournament Director, is going to give a brief presentation on the impacts that we've had in this city. But I wanted to first start out and first of all, thank you all and thank our great community and many of the people that were here earlier and left, many of our partners and sponsors. You know, we wouldn't be where we were if it wasn't for the great support of the City of Palm Beach Gardens and, of course, our great community. And we're going to talk briefly about charity numbers and economic impacts as well. But, you know, it's from the bottom of our heart. You guys have been fantastic partners for us over the last 9 years. We're jumping into year 10 now. We can't believe it. However, the tournament has been here really for four additional years at Marisol. So, you know, the City of Palm Beach Gardens has been phenomenal. The international television truly around the world has been great. We had a recent Junior Honda Classic winner this past weekend. We had three winners from international parts of the world. Our oldest boy was from Iceland, so he took the Junior Honda Classic trophy back to Iceland with him. The woman 16 to 18, from Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. She took the Junior Honda Classic trophy back there. And a young boy, and I sent some links to two Irish news stations that aired yesterday. Thomas McKibben, a 12-year-old boy, took the boy's 12- and 13-year-old trophy back to Northern Ireland. The first tweet he received was from our past champion, Rory McIlroy, congratulating him on his championship. But in that news clip, they specifically referenced not only the Junior Honda Classic, but Palm Beach Gardens, Florida. So it was a phenomenal Junior Honda Classic for us, just another extension of what we do. So again, Andrew will present here in a minute. I did want to address one item that has been broached. American Honda Corporation, our title sponsor, has been our sponsor for 35 years. They're the longest running sponsor on the PGA Tour. We're in discussions with them. Their current agreement ends at the post-16 event. I will tell you that the conversations for extension of our title sponsorship are going well. So therefore, we hope to make a great announcement at the Honda Classic February 22nd to 28th, if not a little bit before, about an extension. But again, details are still to be worked out on that. And last, from my standpoint, I did want to reference, as many of you know, we lost one of our great leaders, one of our board members, one of our great friends of golf, Mallory Privet, who was a phenomenal man and obviously a fabulous member of the Palm Beach Gardens community. We lost him on December 26th. After a long bout with cancer. But we're going to be recognizing Mallory at the tournament and his wonderful family. We recognized him the past 2 days of the Junior Honda Classic as well. But I did want to, on the record, at least reference that because he was a great man of golf. He loved golf. He loved the City of Palm Beach Gardens. And obviously, he started his career here with Pratt & Whitney as an engineer. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Andrew George, who's our great tournament director and our great leader of this team, to give you all a little snapshot as to the impacts that the Honda Classic has had on the community over, certainly from the 15 tournament, but before that as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Ken. And thank you guys again for having us in here. You know, it's crazy to see that time, you know, up on the clock at 45 days. So we're pumped to go in it. You know, looking back to 15, I think the first thing that we do as a staff is really look at the overall impact. Certainly the weather we had on Saturday was memorable. So we got together as an operations team, and also with American Honda in a contract year, want to make sure we got some additional branding for them. So I think we've got a concept ready for 2016 for everybody if we do have that same weather system come through.
We won't need it.
It's all about preparation, right? Just kind of reviewing the economic impact, you know, we're really excited when we got our study back to see that, again, we had a record $48 million to the local community this year, up from $40 million the year before. And we noticed that is coming from out of town, coming in to showcase this beautiful city. We had 15% increase in our hotel room nights in Palm Beach Gardens in 2015 and look to be up again for 2016. So we're excited to have people from all over the country. We had 30,000 visitors from outside Florida come in for just the tournament week from 24 different states and 25 different countries that we accounted for, and I'm sure many, many more. The charitable giving number, again, a record $2.55 million, even with all the weather and the challenges we had, a partnership that we had, obviously, across the board with both the city, with PGA National, and with our great sponsors, we were able to have that record $2.55 million. That brings our 9-year total to impacting over 300 charities and a $13.2 million distribution from the tournament to charities in the local community. That includes $3.1 million to Nicholas Children's Healthcare Foundation. And the Birdies for Children program, since 2010 in the inception, thanks to American Honda providing a brand new Honda car to the winner of that program each year, we're up over $4 million as of 2015. Ken referenced it, the broadcast has gone international. The growth has been amazing to see, especially the last 3 to 4 years. We now have over 55 hours of coverage. That includes the replay that following week after the tournament, although, you know, this past year we were still playing into the following week for the tournament. That is on NBC, Golf Channel, and Sky Sports in 2015 took a much bigger stake in the tournament to make sure to get coverage over to Europe and to Asia. Telecast has jumped to 925 million homes in 226 countries and territories. That's a 35% increase just since 2013. We're really excited as a tournament staff in the ability to showcase the city, showcase the county through digital coverage. PGA Tour, while there's certainly regulations on the broadcast and minimal time to be on NBC, there's unlimited potential. The growth from the digital side on PGA Tour Live has grown, I think, 350%. Since 2014, so there's a lot of opportunities going forward for that crowd. And then we tallied up over 52 minutes of in-broadcast coverage, focusing on Palm Beach Gardens through the NBC and Golf Channel coverage this last year. You know, our focus since 2007 has been year-round community involvement here with the city. I know it looks like a lot of logos on there, but each of those events is very important to keeping the Honda Classic name, American Honda, and of course the City of Palm Beach Gardens relevant 365. As Ken mentioned, the Junior Honda Classic, which we just had, we had participants from 20 different countries come fly in, stay at PGA National, participate in that great event. And then as Charlotte mentioned, you know, our focus moving forward is very much about the Honda Classic Cares tagline. As many of you know, the PGA Tour is a very unique property in that, you know, every dollar net proceeds for each tournament, as you watch on TV, each of those tournaments is giving back to the local community. We've had a lot of different initiatives in that charitable function, whether it was Birdies for Children or grants or special restrictive gifts. We wanted to bring that all together under one tagline. So as you go forward, you'll see we've got our team member driving that Honda Classic Cares van around town. We had our first ever Honda Classic Cares reception, a celebration of philanthropy this summer. And our mission, obviously, moving forward is to continue to give back and make an impact in the local community. What does that look like? In 2015, it was over $2.55 million. More specifically, it was 15,000 kids and families that were directly impacted in Palm Beach Gardens, and that was going through 129 different charitable organizations. And I wanted to show, you'll start to see these as we roll them out. We want to highlight each of the local organizations that we are partnering with in a bigger way. You'll see these start to pop up on TV as we move forward, but here's two that I wanted to show from this past year.
I was born like this, only that they were together, so the doctor told me he had to do a surgery and open them so I can grab these.
There's really no barrier for anyone when it comes to golf. The confidence is just quadrupled since he's been here.
I never thought I would go this far. First guy to play golf, two fingers. I want to be like how God made me. Because I just say nothing is possible.
The Honda Classic, yes, is wonderful for my family.
Felipe there was our winner of the art contest. Each year we have, through the Palm Beach County Schools, invite students to portray what they think the Honda Classic is all about. And Felipe was our winner in 2015. We make up a credential for every kid that comes through the gates gets to wear that artwork piece that he had done. And with that, it kind of incited him into getting into the game of golf and through the first tee of Palm Beach as he's now playing, you know, every weekend out there at Dyer Park.
Foster care as a whole in our community is in a crisis. So Village of Hope is a transitional housing and support program that takes them through that transition from childhood to healthy adulthood.
Having a place to go when I was turning 18 and aging out of foster care was extremely important for me because this is the first footstep of living on your own.
And the fact that the Honda Classic stepped in at a super critical time and built the very first home for that in this entire region. The Honda Classic cares about the children and youth in our community.
So again, you're going to see more of those PSAs. We really want to highlight celebrate the partnerships we have with local charities. We really appreciate the ability to have the partnership with you as the City of Palm Beach Gardens, PJ National, and we're excited for the 2016 tournament coming up.
Thank you again for your great support. We wouldn't be there without you all. Thank you.
And thank you also.
Thank you very much.
It's a golf show tonight. The next item on the agenda, again, Charlotte Prusinski for the record. Very honored to be here. We're honored to be here. We have the management staff of the golf course because we want to recognize a very special group of people that make our city golf course be what it is. We lost a few, but we had a good contingent out tonight. It's really important that we share with the community when people give back what happens. And people ask, what do golf course volunteers do? Well, first of all, for us, they are such an integral part of our operation. 50% or more of the time when someone comes to the golf course, their very first person that they encounter is probably a volunteer. And that's special because they care, they're doing it for their love of the course. And because of that, our ratings, when people go online, give us 100% recommendation to play the course. But when they write out why, they talk about the friendliness of people. And that's important, as you know, to retain people when you're operating a thing such as a golf course. So what they do for us, summer pro shop assistants, they're the ones who help answer phones, book tee times, help customers, get them checked in, get them out to the course in time. We have range attendants. Those are the people that help you up on the range. They move you to your tee time, but also they do manual labor. They fill the divots. When everybody warms up, it helps in the growth of the grass. Our rangers, they're the ones that you see out there, move you along if you're playing a little bit slow, but they do it in a very friendly manner. And also, not only do they do that, but they're integral to our turf care program. Every day when they start their shift, they're roaming the course, filling divots, punching greens, and the best thing that could have ever been told to me by our city manager was when he played golf on a Sunday, he had no divots to fill, and that was because our great volunteers were out there in front of him. Program assistants, they're integral to teaching our kids. You can see in this picture, that's Bruce, he's here, but there are others that work, and our golf program has grown under our coach, our head professional, Sherry Pla. But it's also because of the giving back of those volunteers. Our youth program, I would put our youth golfers up just against any group out there, and we would probably take home the trophy. They're that good because of the volunteers. They're also cart attendants. They're the people who greet you, handle your bag, make sure you get on your way. They're the ones who get you. They greet you first, and they're the first smiling face. Lastly, they're tournament and event support. I can't say enough about this. You know the goodwill we do through the Gardens Cup and the Mayor's Veterans Golf Tournament. Without our volunteers, those events would not happen. We simply do not have enough paid staff to pull those off. So without them, we could not give back to the charities that we do. And last but not least, they do anything we ask them to do. It is amazing how when we can put a call out, if somebody's not there and they show up, there's not any amount of rain or cold or hundreds of divots that need to be filled or amount of trash or slow golfers or the number of carts that need to be cleaned that can stop these people. They are amazing. Just to give you an idea, we're going to give you a little bit of estimate by the numbers what their volunteerism means to us. We have 33 registered volunteers. When I say 33, that means they applied, filled out a background check, and if they work with youth, they've completed a fingerprint process. Last year, about 1,500 shifts were filled and over 8,000 hours of work. That's a tremendous amount of work given back to our golf course. Based upon national standards, their rate would be over $13 an hour, and we would have paid out $115,000 in salaries if they were not helping us. That is the value that they bring to our community. Before I put up the next slide, I'm going to ask everyone to hold their applause. But if I could have our volunteer corps stand up and our management team stand up, because this next slide is for you. Well, hold your applause, please. Valuable is the work you do. Outstanding in how you always come through. Loyal, sincere, and full of good cheer. Untiring in your efforts throughout the year. Notable are the contributions you make. Trustworthy in every project you take. Eager to reach your every goal. Effective in the way you fulfill your role. Ready with a smile like a shining star. Special and wonderful. That's what you are. We want to thank you. And if I could have the council come down, we'd like to get a picture. Volunteers, please come up. We'd like to get a picture. And while we're taking the picture, there is the phone number, and Gabe is right here. If anyone else would like to help us at the golf course, we're always looking for new volunteers. We want to capture this picture so we can put it up in our temporary clubhouse, so that would be great. Look at Candace. That's true. Wonderful. Thank you very much.
I'm getting ready. I'm not a techie.
Those cuckoos are very nice. Nice music.
Marie Caracuso from Palm Beach Gardens Elementary. We started prematurely because I'm not a techie and I'm not sure how to use everything, but this is just an example of our STEAM Choice program at Palm Beach Gardens Elementary. Council members and Mayor Javelin, thank you for having me today. So just a little video montage. And when you look at some of the things we do in the community, this is our walk to school day, annual walk to school day with our families. We also have STEAM activities going on throughout the day, every day in our classes. STEAM meaning science, technology, engineering, arts, and math integration. You have a pen, you have a flyer. Thank you for inviting me. These are all the things we do. Kids make pinwheels, they're creating, they're being creative, they're in arts. I want to mention we also have a wonderful art program. We do participate in Art Igraw every year. I noticed they mentioned the First Tee. We love having First Tee come for our aftercare program. It's a wonderful program. Here are little scientists. We have science on our wheel and engineering. So our students are actually doing engineering. Garden, we have clubs. Some of our many clubs include 3D printing, CrossFit, K-Kids, band, Spanish, art, chess, mad science, and of course our gardening. And these are just some of the activities you'll see here. I want to include today some of our local Palm Beach Gardens business partners include California Pizza Kitchen and Valley National Bank and DoubleTree by Hilton both represent on our SAC committee this year. Taylor Orthodontics as well and many other local family sponsors. And here we are with some of our clubs. In addition, we do community service at our school. At Palm Beach Gardens Elementary, we have about 740 students. We are an A-rated school, and we include food drives through our K-Kids and Caps for Love, which is an organization that collects caps, and they send them in to purchase wheelchairs for students who can't afford wheelchairs. We also have Larry Clausen's school, who's following me, Palm Beach Gardens High School, does a lot of things with us. They come for our field day. Their sports magnet students come and organize and run our whole field day in the spring. They help judge our science fair in February. And they also do junior achievement, which helps teach our kids about citizenship and responsible citizenship in the community. We also have Palm Beach State College that comes to our STEAM night in the fall, and they do a partnership with us that we had students that came and presented about engineering and science careers. And we have Palm Beach Gardens Police Department and Fire Department, who we absolutely adore. They come and they visit and they give presentations to all of our students, especially kindergarten and younger grades. Jennifer Bashir from Palm Beach Gardens also does the joy drive in the winter for our students, and our families come and help wrap and things like that. So we do that drive with Palm Beach Gardens, City of Palm Beach Gardens. We have family nights. We do partnerships with the Apple Store. Recently, we were doing the week of coding, and our students participated in that. If you're ever interested in looking at some of the things to keep up daily, I am on Twitter, and my account is PBGES Principal. So feel free to like me, and then you can see kind of the neat things we do throughout the year. I want to thank you for having me this evening. I did have my STEAM Choice coordinator with me earlier, but her two little ones were getting tired. They had to go home. So we didn't realize how long. You guys probably are similar to the school board meetings, but thank you for having me. I appreciate it. Any questions? All right. Thank you, and I appreciate
it. Such a big part of our community.
Yeah. Bert?
Well, we love it. You know, we've been here since 1964, and we have a new building. Anytime, come down and visit us. I know Bert's been there, and David, of course. Marcy, yes, we appreciate you coming.
Great.
When we do our mayor, we have a mayor, and we do the BizTown, yeah.
Swearing the mayor.
Yes, yeah, we appreciate
been
that.
Been there a few times, and you know, Bert's an alumni.
No,
what?
I didn't go there.
I thought you went there.
I went
there.
To Peter Pan next door.
You did?
Really?
I went to Peter Pan, and then I went over to North Palm to St. Clair, so no, I didn't get a chance to go.
Okay.
Well, he's an alumni of the next presenter.
Very nice.
Yes.
Yeah. No, it's a great community. A lot of our teachers are alumni. Yeah, a lot of our parents. It's really a neat little community, gardens. Yeah. I am now a resident of Gardens as well for 2 years now. So, yes, I'm very proud to be a resident. So thank you for
inviting. Going to have any alumni reunions in the future? You know, it's funny I say that because I'm going to a reunion of my public school in May.
Oh, wow.
And it's a lot of fun to you know. You should do it. You should do it.
Yeah.
Bring the first graders back 30 years from now.
Yeah, 30 years from now.
There you go.
They'd love to compare notes.
Thank you. That was
Thank
awesome.
Thank you. Have a nice night.
Thank you. Thank you. Principal Larry Clausen, you're next.
Thank you. Let's see if I can get to okay. All right. Before I start the video that we have from our school, I do want to take just a brief second to thank Mr. Mayor, the council members for giving us the opportunity to come and kind of highlight what goes on at Palm Beach Gardens High School. For Bert and David and Marcy, hopefully your children have enjoyed their time at Palm Beach Gardens High School, and we've prepared them for post-secondary education, and Bert, you're going to be finding that out soon. And Mayor, thank you for participating in our homecoming. And I'd like to just reference the city manager, Ferris, and Councilman Lohman. I think the first conversation we had was my first week on the job, and we were arguing over the marquee at Gardens High School. I've been a principal there for 7 years, and I got cited twice by the code enforcement my first week of school, and I had nothing to do with any of it. But I said at that very first meeting, my goal was to be a good neighbor. And in the 7 years that I've been a principal there, 27 years in the district, after being in, I live in Lake Worth, I've been in the south and central area in the district, and coming to Palm Beach Gardens for the last last 7 years, being part of a community has really, really been something special. I have to have a special thank you to Chief Stepp and Chief Southard for their services. The services that we get through fire rescue and through the police department are greatly appreciated and second to none. Laura and Justin and Jack for the Parks and Recreation, we have the greatest facilities that we're able to utilize in Palm Beach County. And I thought for a second there might have been somebody here from the district, because I understand there's a whole other thing we're going through. Can you and I sit down and do that so we don't have to get them involved? Anyway, thank you. Thank you. And thank you for allowing us to continue every year to have our homecoming parade from Marie's school down to our school. The community enjoys it. Our kids at the school love it. There's not very many schools that still get to do it. We're one of the few. And with the city and everybody that helps make it possible, it truly is special. I did bring a short video that we use for marketing that kind of highlights things that are going on at Gardens High School. And if I can make this work, I will try to start it.
You know, you have another alum right over there, Derek Craig.
Palm Beach Gardens High School offers a state-of-the-art campus and a competitive curriculum, preparing today's students for tomorrow's careers. No matter where you live in Palm Beach County, students can sign up and attend Palm Beach Gardens High School and be a part of one of its six choice programs, each of which allows the students to earn college credit and receive certifications in their chosen field. They are pre-medicine, television and film production, sports management and recreation, global business and entrepreneurship, tourism, hospitality and resort management, and culinary arts. Taking a look at these programs, we start with pre-medicine.
Hey, are you okay?
He's not responding. Call 911 and get an AED.
Students get to practice emergency medicine. They diagnose fellow students who pose as patients, and they volunteer at Palm Beach Gardens Medical Center.
I just really want them to have a passion for whatever branch of medicine they're going to go into.
Students who complete the course have a chance to be a certified nursing assistant and receive college credit. These students are on their way to saving lives. There's also television and film production technology.
Okay, let me have camera 3 with a box, please.
In this program, the students gather news, write scripts, and put a newscast together.
He teaches us and then lets us do it. I was like, I want this program. I want to be in this program. I want to learn everything. And like once I knew,
I fell in love, honestly.
In sports management and recreation, students become proficient in the Microsoft Office products. They also learn about marketing, management, and finance.
If you love athletics, you can still work in athletics and be a part of the background scenes instead of being that professional player out on the field.
The students organize their own golf tournament, and they've taken field trips to local sports stadiums to learn about running a professional sports team.
It's more like in the fields, and you get to go on field trips and see like real businesses and stuff.
Global business and entrepreneurship. In this program, the students learn about investing.
So there's the stock price.
They get certified in computer programs, and they also get the chance to receive college credit. The program will help students who want to compete in a global economy.
Then there is nowhere else I'd rather work than in this program and at Palm Beach Gardens High School.
The Culinary Arts Program trains students in the field of food service and preparation. They learn about cooking, cost control, and nutrition. Students can receive a SafeServe certification, which helps them in the food industry. Everywhere you turn at Palm Beach Gardens High School, you see pride. Pride in the sports teams. Pride in the clubs. The campus and the classes.
That's why you entered as the numeric label.
There are many teachers that actually care for you and that want the best for you.
I like going to Palm Beach Gardens High School because the people are really fun and amazing.
There's different clubs you can join. There's different like magnets you can be in.
I like all the people here. They're all really friendly.
The campus looks great. The students are good.
Four, five.
I love the people. I've made some amazing friends here.
Honestly, everything's great here. All the teachers are really nice. There's so many friendly people, and the programs are just great here.
Yes, the students at Palm Beach Gardens High School definitely have Gator pride.
We're orange and blue.
The school district of Palm Beach County, your best choice.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity to share that with you all. And again, if one thing I did forget, and I'll close on it, is the other part about being part of a community. We have the largest business magnet advisory board in Palm Beach County School District. Every once a month, we have a meeting, and there's over 45 to 50 business members or people from the city that attend our meeting to give our students opportunities to participate in groundhog shadowing opportunities, internships. People come in to do lectures. So we really have truly something special at Palm Beach Gardens High School, and I truly believe that it's because we're in the community of Palm Beach Gardens. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you both. Sorry, thank you very much.
Any questions?
You said 45 to 50 in the magnet?
Yeah, our magnet advisory board is huge.
You know, because I used to serve on that, and we had maybe 12, 15 people come. Oh, that's great.
It's well, Bert's been there, and David was there for a while, and it's really
That's excellent. That's
it's
really
amazing.
Excellent.
And a
that's
lot of great. It has to do with the founding father, the godfather, who's recently retired, Artie Falk.
Yeah, Artie's great.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Does he
thank
still
you
do the football games?
Yeah, actually,
Oh, that's great.
That's great.
That's great.
That's great.
So okay. All of our students have graduated from there, right?
Almost. Bert's going to be graduating.
You still got Reedy still there,
senior,
right?
And a sophomore, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Larry's right, the advisory board. When these people get together, it's people from all different facets of businesses throughout the community. And when they meet and they get together and they talk about ideas and issues and fundraising and getting these kids involved in as many activities as they can, that maybe they can't afford to do it or can't be financed by the school board. As we know, their budgets fluctuate and change from year to year. But this is really a great team of people that help with all the magnet programs, which is really nice to get together. And yeah. I enjoy being on it, and I'll continue to hopefully stay on it if Larry lets me in the door.
What is it, Larry? It's about $20,000 a year that's raised through, like, the golf tournament, and we did the Roosevelt EC and –
Mm-hmm.
went twice. Very scary, chaperoning kids to New York City.
Man, just the competition.
But a lot of fun.
The competitions, these kids compete. Yeah, these kids compete in competitions at the state, then they have to go out to nationals and other programs that need funding.
The FBLA, I mean, it's impressive. The Future Business Leaders of America has a contest every year. I know Gardens has done quite well in that.
Largest chapter.
Wow. Absolutely.
In the nation.
Yep. In the nation.
It's impressive.
Not the state,
impressive.
Not the county, the nation.
All right. Thanks for the 2 hours, Larry. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Okay, next is Adam Savai, resident interest and board and committee reports.
Seeing the hour, I'm just going to wish everyone Happy New Year. I'm going to ask for you to vote for my photograph in the Florida State Park photo contest for January. And ironically, and so the council members will know why this is ironic, it's a picture of a Florida scrub jay taken at Jonathan Dickinson State Park. So if you'll vote for that, go to floridastateparks.org, go to photo contest, January 2016.
I'm going to remind everybody to vote on March 15th, okay? Plenty of time for that.
Gotta remind everybody to come out to the green market on Sunday.
That's what I was about to do.
I'm sorry.
No. 14th anniversary, we're going to be cutting a lot of cakes and giving a lot of food away. So please come out. I think we start around 10 o'clock. The market starts at 8, but I think we start our festivities at 10. So please come out. It's a lot of fun, and it's good food. Okay.
I just want to say one thing. I just want to say, again, well, two things. I want to wish everybody a very happy and healthy new year, and I hope 2016 will be filled with prosperity and peace to all. And I also want to congratulate Miss Kenthia White, who recently graduated with honors from Palm Beach State College.
Hey. Hey. Amen. That's great. That's great.
Sorry,
I know she avoided. I know she avoided taking environmental geology.
I'll say the same thing as Marcy. Happy New Year and congratulations.
Happy New Year, everybody. Okay. All right. Next is comments from the public for items not on the agenda, and I have two. One is Barry Mendelowitz. Is Barry here? Oh, there he is.
Good evening, Council. I'm here to discuss Shady Lakes Extension, and I'd like to get Council Members Marcy Tinsley's attention on this specifically, because you were present at the school board conversation related to tying into 117th Court. And
I hope you're addressing your remarks to all of us, because that's what you have to do, Barry. Thank you.
You're welcome to listen. Thank you. I am concerned that Ms. Tinsley also is well aware of the recreational needs, because I've sat in on recreational meetings. And I sent you an email, and I will put this into the record, that we as a community met with the representatives of the school board in regards to the possible road improvements to 117th Court. And we understand the school board is more than willing to convey the school road to the city. Your staff has to have put together a quick claim deed along with conditions to submit to the school board. Yet we as a community have not received any of that information from your staff. Shady Lakes Boulevard has been on the city thoroughfare plan designated to carry huge amounts of traffic from PJ Boulevard to the school road, 117th Court, and has been an issue for quite some time. This will require your immediate action as the entire council to remove it from the city thoroughfare plan. The city council and staff have never met with our neighboring associations or the school board to discuss in a transparent fashion the adverse impact such a thoroughfare boulevard would have on the school children attending the school, parents at the drop-off, pickup, and residents of this city. There has been no details, no updates given by staff on connecting Shady Lakes Drive to 117th Court and improving 117th Court. Therefore, your website doesn't have anything either. The school board has already provided the information to the city of improvements which the city must make to Hunter 17th Court. Therefore, there's no better time than now to meet with you, Ms. Tinsley, and the school representatives and our community. And we wish you would please do that. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Barry. But these remarks need to be addressed to the entire council, not to individuals. If you want to speak to individuals, you can communicate with them on your own. Thank you. Yeah, I do. Kathy Beamer.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and council members. My name is Kathy Beamer. I live at 2258 Quail Ridge North, Palm Beach Gardens. I've been a very enthusiastic resident of Palm Beach Gardens for 36 years, residing in my current home in Shady Lakes for the last 31. As you may remember, I came before this council last month to express my concern regarding the way you are proceeding on the extension of Shady Lakes Drive prior to the consideration of the improvements that need to be made to 117th Court, and that there is going to be chaos if you do the change, if you do this extension of Shady Lakes and you don't do changes to 117th Court. At that meeting last month, Council Member Russo suggested the need for a study to determine the best way to deal with children's safety and also access to the city park. Let's get organized and do exactly that. That is the way to proceed. And yet, it's being totally ignored, and this council is directing the manager to proceed, plow forth with the extension, with no consideration of 117th. Many citizens of Palm Beach Gardens, not only the residents of Shady Lakes, Garden Lakes, Gardens of Woodbury, and Midtown, are going to be seriously affected and adversely affected. I wish that you would please give our communities attention that is not being given. Last council meeting, there were about 70 Shady Lakes residents here. A few of us got to express ourselves. When the three-minute sessions were over, we were invited with a recess to go ahead and depart. Well, I listened to the remainder of the meeting later and found out that the manager's report was next, and that he stated at the beginning of the manager's report that it's just too bad that those people left. They should have stayed. They would have heard my report on what's going on. Well, we're not all that sophisticated, guys. We did not know, because it was not on the agenda anywhere, that there'd be anything more said about Shady Lakes after we left. And I don't know if you as the council members would know that, but certainly the manager could have said, oh, by the way, you may want to wait just a couple minutes and you'll hear our report on what is going on, or my report, excuse me, on what is going on. But that did not occur. I would request that in the future, if indeed there is going to be within the manager's report and not on the agenda, so we don't know about it, that you will tell us and we will go ahead and stay. On a different note, I would ask that there be the meeting with respect to the school board, my community, and the city council. I understand Ms. Tinsley is indeed the point person and the person we've been directed to go to on this issue. And we've been trying for almost 7 weeks, I believe, for that meeting to occur. So I would appreciate it if we could get that meeting. And again, I ask you, please don't go forth. Take a breath. Improve 117th. We might not even need the extension. Thank you.
Thank you.
I do want to respond in just a couple of things. I want to ask our manager to explain as well. But I do want to say that I have responded to the emails, and I did say I explained the process. I explained that after all of this hearing, our hearing last night, that I would work on scheduling a meeting. But we had a few things that we had to do prior to that. One was we were still talking to the school board and putting together that graphic. We needed to take that time and do it properly. So that was what I said in the response. I wasn't ignoring anybody. I responded appropriately. I also worked with the city manager to communicate to the school board. So I'd like the city manager to add as well.
As has been stated in previous meetings, and information is on the website, we have had meetings. at Midtown Residential Community. We met Tuesday, November the 10th at 6 p.m. And by the way, if you missed something at this council meeting that you're interested in, you can always go back to our website and see the entire council meeting because it is recorded audio and visual. So we had a Midtown Residential meeting on Tuesday, November the 10th. Shady Lakes HOA, those seven residents, which some of you are included, staff did meet with you on November the 12th, a Thursday, and we were told by the HOA president that they would like to meet, but that December was a bad month, and they would let us know when they wanted to meet in January. So you're waiting for 7 weeks for a meeting. If you could get your HOA president, and maybe you are the president, to give us a call back, perhaps maybe we could sit down with the entire HOA and just not seven residents that live next to the road. We had a meeting with Midtown Commercial on November the 16th, Hampton K, November the 18th, Gardens Lakes, December 9th, Gardens of Woodbury, not interested. Bent Tree, not interested. I think we're trying to do as much as we can as far as outreach to the community is concerned. The purpose of these meetings is to talk to the residents before we do anything as far as the design of the road is concerned. In addition to that, we brought forth to the council an estimated project timeline. As you can see, in November, December, we talked about the budget, purchase award of contracts for professional services that we need to use in order to do further research and community outreach, which we have completed except for meeting with the big HOA association within Shady Lakes. In January to February, we have our data collected. We are now looking at purchasing the services of a surveyor so we can actually define where the property lines are on that right of way. After that, we will hire an engineer to begin dealing with the issues and the challenges that Shady Lakes project will bring to us. In the spring, we'll continue to work on the planning, design, and engineering, and at a certain point, I forget if it's 50 or 75% drawings, we'll go back to those communities that express a desire for us to come back to them and talk to them about where we're going and what the progress is that has been made as far as the engineering and designing is concerned of Shady Lakes. The bidding and award, once those are done, sometime in the summer, and then late summer, if everything is on schedule, we'll do construction. As far as the school board and 117th, we have a very long history of trying to get the title to 117th. Not only the title, but we've also have a long history of trying to convince the schools and their administration more than schools of different methods that was recommended by our police department and engineering to be able to deal with the traffic. Falls on deaf ears. They don't listen and they do not take action. We have tried to obtain the right of way on 117th on at least three occasions that I know of, and we do not get a response from administration at the school. We have, as of today, I believe, our attorney transmitted the final request for the quitclaim deed, and we will be happy to put that on our website. We'll try to get that up tomorrow with a conceptual design. It is certainly not an engineer. It's just an idea of something that might work, which it includes improvements to 117th. I understand that you have some kind of a desire to put alternatives on 117th, but this is our program, and we'd be happy to talk to you about that once we have something to talk to you about. This is our project timeline. This is what the council has agreed to, and I know that Councilwoman Tinsley and staff have met with the school board. Our attorney has had many conversations with the school board and the administration, it's a continuing dialogue. It's not done, it's not over. We're still talking about it. So that's the facts as I know them.
I do want to assure you that before it ever comes to a vote here on the council or brought before us, it will be on an agenda and it will say a name to where you can actually see it. How I and every other council member reads our backup information is right on the website, just like every other one of you. Any person in the public can read and look at everything on the website as we do. That's how we get our information. That's how we read all of our backup material. Right there on the first page. And it's my understanding that Shady Lakes, all the information we have and have discussed is on the website, and it's not hidden or buried. It's right there on the front page, and you'll just see the name, and you click, and there's like a hyperlink, and you can kind of drill down and get further information. So it will be noticed. It will be publicly noticed, as is every one of our city council meetings. And when we're actually specifically wanting to talk about that subject, for voting on that subject, I mean, it will be on the agenda with the name. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Marcy. You've made your report?
I did.
Is that it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, all right. Next is the consent agenda.
Excuse me, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to want to ask that item B be pulled, resolution 3. And I also want to, on the record, ask the city attorney on resolution 7, which is a plat for the CVS PUD. When that originally was voted on, I had a conflict because one of my clients had owned a building that CVS, I guess, was purchasing. And I had asked him whether I could vote on this. And Max, you said that this was only a plat, and now again, this doesn't affect my client anymore.
Yes, you mean resolution 11. Yes.
11, right.
No, it shouldn't. It should not represent. You don't have any business. You don't represent anybody that has any business interests in the in any of the property.
No, CVS wasn't big enough for me to do. So.
and a plat is largely ministerial in nature, in that once it meets technical compliance, we're actually compelled to adopt.
Okay, that's fine. So the only thing I am going to ask is item B be pulled.
Move consent with the exception.
Wait. No, I'm Bert's
okay.
Got something.
I'm okay
oh,
with
Bert's
that.
Bert's got something.
Because, I had the same
issue. Are you okay
with
D as well?
I had the same issue with Resolution 11D with a client owning one of those parcels as well. But has that property changed hands? CVS is the actual owner now?
Yes.
That's a closed sale?
Yes, they have.
Okay, so it doesn't affect me because right. I don't bank CVS. Sorry.
Okay, so it's just B. So, David?
Move consent with the exception of item B.
Second.
Move and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Passes 5-0. Okay, move.
Resolution 3, Mr. Mayor, I sit on the board of the Children's Healthcare Charities. I also serve as a treasurer. I am not compensated in any way or receive any type of benefits. It's a volunteer job for charity, but yet I don't feel it's right that I vote on this with the city having an agreement with the charity.
I agree.
Okay, well, so I'll be abstaining.
Okay, well, let's move the consent agenda first, okay?
We did.
No.
Yeah, David moved it.
Oh, I thought we just moved to take Resolution 3 off. Okay. All right, okay. Chair, I'll entertain a motion on Resolution 3.
Oh, did we vote for consent?
Got to read it by title.
Resolution 3, 2016, a resolution of the City Council of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, awarding a public safety grant for off-duty police and fire personnel to the Children's Healthcare Charity Incorporated for the 2016 Honda Classic PGA Golf Tournament and to approve a lease agreement for the use of specific portions of Mirasol and PGA National Parks for various parking facilities and general operations, providing an effective date and further purposes.
But the chair will entertain a motion.
Move Resolution 3, 2016.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Passes 5-0.
4-0.
Okay. 4-0. Sorry. You're right. Oh, man, I'll tell you. Okay. Public hearings. We're ready on public forum. Yeah, we've done that. No, we moved 9. Okay. Resolution 9, 2016. This is a public hearing. I'm going to open the public hearing. Clerk will read the title, please.
Resolution 9, 2016, a resolution of the City Council of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, amending the City of Palm Beach Gardens budget for the fiscal year beginning October 1, 2015 and ending September 30, 2016 inclusive, by approving the transfer of funds pursuant to Section 2-293 Appropriations Code of Ordinances to fund the cost of body-worn camera program for the fiscal year ending September 30, 2016, authorizing the city manager to take certain actions to implement the body-worn camera program, providing an effective date for the purposes.
Thank you, Patty. I've opened the public hearing. Can we have a staff presentation, please?
Good evening. For the record, Stephen Stepp, Chief of Police. This is Resolution 9, 2016, concerning body-worn camera program. First, I'd like to start out with a little bit of the history of the city's examination of the body-worn cameras. Back 3 or 4 years ago, the police department tested and evaluated several body camera technologies that were existing at the time. Unfortunately, we weren't satisfied, but we did see that there was a future potential for the technology and decided to monitor those changes over the next couple years. Then in September, learning of some new changes that had taken place, I met with the Palm Beach Gardens Police Foundation and asked them to consider funding a pilot program, and they earmarked grant funding for that when it was needed. Then in November of 2014, we attended the International Association of Chiefs of Police Conference in Orlando to learn about the new advancements that had recently taken place in the body-worn camera technology. We had the opportunity to meet with experts and vendors who were present at the conference. Along with myself, I brought some command staff members, some officers, a union rep, our IT people, and a member of the Police Foundation with us. Then in mid-2015, we learned of some additional advancements that were expected in hardware, records management, and some legislation that was taking place at a state level, and also that the city of West Palm Beach had decided to move forward with their program. So in November of 2015, we met with West Palm Beach to evaluate its implementation of the body camera system that they were deploying and felt pretty good about it at the time. Therefore, in December 7th, we had a presentation by two nationally known body camera vendors, both ViView, VView, and the Axon product. With them, we discussed changes in technology, such as the hardware, the cameras, storage, records management systems, cost, and then we had further discussion about new policies and legislative changes related to public records. In order to move forward with the program, it will involve a comprehensive initiative that will include the development of policies, conducting a pilot program, training of our people, staffing for two positions, both an IT and a records position, and then the plan for data storage and expanding our records management system. Then we'll be able to assess the program along the way at each step, making any changes that are needed along the way, and finally going to a full implementation of the body-worn camera system. This is a brief timeline outlining a lot of what needs to be done along the way. We've started this past fall, back in December, and wish to move forward with the idea that we believe we have a reasonable timeline set up here for a full implementation by the summertime. This is some of the equipment that will be used. The photo on the left describes a battery, the square, flat in the palm of the hand there is the battery and on-off switch. And just in front of that, the cigar-shaped black item is the camera itself. Those items will be placed on an officer to wear. The photo on the right involves, this would take place at the station, and is a photo of what would normally be a docking station for downloading data in order to recharge the equipment. When we look at the total equipment and staffing cost for this year, it comes out to $262,296. Now I'd like to switch over for a moment and let you know about some additional initiatives we've been working with very closely with the Palm Beach County Clergy Alliance. We've been meeting with them for several months now in discussions, idea sharing, and partnering for the future. With help from them, we've been able to push this body camera initiative along quickly, and that's why it's here today. But I wanted to go over some additional initiatives that we've been working with them on. One has to do with the tactical training facility, which we've been trying to bring forth for the last couple of years. Has to do with high liability areas such as driving, use of force, and response to resistance. Our goal there is to create an environment that puts our officers in high-risk, low-frequency scenarios under stress to emphasize the best practices. Some of those best practices that are being found around the country employ using our crisis intervention team training that every one of our officers has gone through, enhanced verbalization techniques, alternatives to use of force, something we call tactical pause, or just trying to slow situations down in order to avoid deadly force scenarios, less lethal techniques, de-escalation techniques, and to practice felony stops and different takedowns that police officers have to do on a regular basis. All this with emphasis on both officer safety and citizen safety. The next bullet has to do with overall policy review. And it's important to note that since the 1990s, we've been both nationally and state accredited agency. Chief Fitzgerald's in the audience tonight. He started the program back in the 90s, took the department to a whole nother level in the city here, and we've continued on with those programs. It's our seventh time being accredited internationally, and our Commission on Florida Accreditation was just here in December to review not only our policies, but to meet with our officers, do ride-alongs, meet with the public, look at proofs of compliance that we're doing things the way that we say that we're doing. But additionally, what I want to add to that bullet is that we're also exploring Community Relations Board or something similar to that to expand our partnerships throughout the region. We've done real well at forming our community partnerships locally, but we see in some of these meetings that we've had that we need to expand that throughout the county and perhaps further to get a good feel for what's going on and how we can provide service to the community even that much better. We've also looked in the next bullet here of strengthening our plainclothes policy. In meeting with the Clergy Alliance, they had a desire to go to Washington to present some ideas on plainclothes policing policies. We met with them and helped them to develop some paperwork to bring up there. Since then, which we now have in place, we've strengthened our own policy on plainclothes officers who are out on the street. So we've moved forward with that. Next bullet has to do with human diversity training. Many of our residents and people within the county are not aware of the human diversity training that has gone on with our department, not only in human diversity, but cultural sensitivity, safe and legal traffic stops, professional policing. These are things that we do year after year. This past year, a new program came out nationally called Fair and Impartial Policing, latest, greatest information on the topic. To my knowledge, we're the first agency in the region that's finished that program department-wide. So we're also working with our HR department at an ongoing program to maximize on things we did a few years ago for citywide employee diversity training. So it won't only just be the police department, the fire department, but all city employees. And we've done that in the past, and we want to continue with that program. So again, we want to continue with the collaboration that we've had with the Palm Beach County Clergy Alliance. A number of their members are here today, and we think that we formed a good partnership with them that will continue to grow over time is our desire. Our recommendation is to approval of Resolution 9-2016 as presented. Be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Mike. Thank you, Chief. Thank you very much. I have several cards on this. I'd like to call you up one by one. And Ray Whiteley, you're first. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm grateful for the opportunity to address this body tonight. I'm even more grateful and humbled to serve my community on this platform. Things happen. We have very little control of what happens to us and around us. What we control totally is our reaction to these events. Corey was our brother and friend, our beloved drummer. His killing sent a shockwave through this community that has left it forever changed. When Corey was murdered, something happened to all of us. Law enforcement failed him, and when it failed him, it failed all of us, including the city of Palm Beach Gardens. So we all had choices to make in reaction to Corey's death. We have seen how this community chose to react. We organized, we rallied, we went to work. We came from all over Palm Beach County. We were peaceful, we were loud, we were relentless. We sought justice and transparency. And at the end of the investigation, we will seek accountability. We saw the police force we deserve, a force that honors its commitment to serving and protecting the public, a force that treats every citizen with the care and respect that we entrusted to deliver. How did this body, this city, choose to react? We heard defensiveness, we heard apprehension, then we experienced cooperation. Then we experienced action. This city chose to acknowledge and act. While this city holds its law enforcement in high regard, it acknowledged that there are some opportunities for improvement. Improvement that can be made to reestablish trust and confidence between the public and law enforcement. The city acknowledged these things that are taken tonight is taking concrete steps to act. We can't bring our brother back. We can't bring any of the victims back. We will mourn their losses forever. But what about the rest of us? What about those who live in Boynton and Lake Worth and Palm Beach who must continue to live here amongst each other, sharing this community and build lives and families? We all have choices of how to react. We are proud to be a part of the action being taken here tonight. We are proud and grateful to the city leaders of Palm Beach County, of Palm Beach Gardens, City Manager Ron Farris, Chief Stepp, Mayor Eric Jablin, Candace Temple, who at first we kind of argued through the first meeting, but we did well. And how it was chosen, and how it has chosen to react. There is work left over to be done. Let us continue to choose justice, transparency, and progress. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend Whitewell. Thank you. Matt Benzion is next. We don't
need to. Good evening, everyone. I'm Matt Benzine, attorney at law, from Palm Beach County, born and raised here, and I've been a Palm Beach Gardens resident before as well. I came here tonight to acknowledge the action that this city council is taking here in Palm Beach Gardens, implementing body cameras for police. A terrible thing happened in this city. A wonderful and loved and innocent young man was murdered, and his death was preventable. And a lot of people in this community are demanding appropriate response from the criminal justice system. And I unfortunately lack faith that we're going to be gratified at the end of the day in that regard. I feel that way because I'm a lawyer and I'm a realist, and we've seen other people killed by police in other places, and we've seen the results in those places. And the problem with those things that happen in those other places across the country and that have been happening for decades is that they have eroded public trust between the public and law enforcement and government generally. And what body cameras do is they help, they're a tool for helping repair that trust. They signify oversight and they bespeak transparency. And so they're good things and I like them, and I'm glad this resolution is being considered and that the chief and that law enforcement organization is supporting the resolution before you this evening. You know, what do we ask of our governing bodies? We ask for you to listen to us, for ourselves to be heard and understood, and we ask for responsiveness. And that's what you're doing this evening. You're taking steps to show that you have heard us and our concerns and that you are responsive. And so, you know, kudos to you guys for undertaking this task and being leaders in this state. So I'm here tonight to voice that recognition and appreciation for your work and for these gentlemen's work over here. I'm from here. I'm here tonight because I'm from here. I've lived here my whole life. Here's home. And I'm here to tell you that I've been here, and we're going to continue to be here, all of us. And words of Dr. King come to mind when I say this, is that human progress is neither automatic nor inevitable. Every step towards justice requires sacrifice, suffering, and struggle, and the tireless exertions and passionate concern of interested and dedicated individuals. So when you take this vote tonight, afterwards, you don't put your pens down and your microphones down, because we're not putting our signs down and our megaphones down. Body cameras are really nice, but they're not the end game. There's a lot more wrongs to right and a lot more attitudes to adjust. And we recognize the responsibility does not fall solely on your shoulders, but you and people like you are essential to progress. And Gandhi said, be the change that you want to see, right? You got to be it. We want to see justice. We want to see accountability and progress. Well, we have to be those things. And tonight, Palm Beach Gardens, you're being the change that we want to see. So thank you very much. I hope you continue to set an example for others. And this community is committed to doing the same thing.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Next is Anthony Maroon. Okay, I'm sorry.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Anthony Maroon. I'm a resident of Palm Beach Gardens. I was a high school classmate of Corey Jones. And I want to take this moment to commend the people here for coming together to take a substantial step towards creating a better, safer environment, a more accountable community for our friends, our family, and our children. Change is the hardest thing to accomplish in life, whether we're talking about individuals or institutions, political bodies. It's very hard. Change takes guts, and change takes will. Change takes desire, and above all, change takes the recognition that there is a need for something to change. Let us not lose the sight of this most important fact. In order for there to be meaningful change, we need meaningful motivation. And Corey's untimely death provided that for us all, if it was lacking. Like I said, I'm a resident of the Gardens. I live here with my wife and my three-year-old son. We've been here for about 3 years. And before I moved back to Florida in 2007, I was active duty in the Marine Corps and deployed, amongst other places, to Iraq, Haiti, Lebanon. And I had to carry a loaded weapon and patrol areas where I was in real fear of my life on a daily basis. I understand the rationale, the psychological shortcuts that we all make to ensure we'll make it home to our families. There was nothing I wouldn't do to make sure I wouldn't get home. There's nothing I wouldn't do to make sure my buddies wouldn't get home and see their families as well. Sometimes we're prisoners of our own making. Sometimes we're prisoners of our circumstances. but I do know one thing: the truth will set us all free. And one of the hardest truths for us to face and even recognize is our own biases, our own faults, our own fears, and our own failures. But it takes courage, and it takes strength, and it takes honor, and it takes wisdom to admit when there are problems and that things need to change. So today I say, City of Palm Beach Gardens, the City Council, the Police Department, the administration, this is a step in the right direction. Keep it up. Be proud of yourselves. There is much more to do. Body cameras aren't a solution in and of themselves. They are a tool at our disposal to use to implement a solution. But this is the beginning of a new mission where we get to redefine what the threats to our community are, who our community is, and how we can be the shining example to other communities that will inevitably go through this as well in our county, our state, and our country. And I thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you for your service. Thank you. Nicholas O'Neill. Thank you.
Nicholas O'Neill, Palm Beach County Clergy Alliance President, future resident of Palm Beach Gardens. Maybe I'll buy one of them new homes that they're talking about developing.
We have some real estate brokers in the
We welcome you in advance.
Amen. There is no greater agony than burying an old untold story inside of you. A words penned by Maya Angelou. I've raised the question several times in my intellect and to God, why Corey Jones, why Palm Beach Gardens? And we know that through the work of Chief Stepp and others, this action tonight was already being planned. But Corey allowed the platform to be for us to help speed up this action, which thankfulness to Candace, to Ron, to Mayor Joblin, and to other council members, poses the question that Martin Luther King asked by simply saying, life's most urgent and persistent question is, what are you doing for others? Tonight, you will vote upon this issue, not just for the betterment of your city, but for the protection of those that your police officers will serve, but it will also protect those police officers in the line of duty. There are good cops, and we're appreciative of that. It's the idiots that want to go rogue every now and then that we must take care of and deal with. And so I'm grateful for our working together these past few months. I'm grateful for you voting in favor of approving this so Ron can do what he does and make his magic work. And you becoming the city that we need to take this movement beyond Palm Beach Gardens, beyond Corey Jones, to the nation and to the world. Thank you for being that stepping stone that does say that all lives matter, but in particular, this is going to help the black lives which are being attacked day in and day out. As you know, there's some white folks taking over government property, and the government hasn't done a thing. But if it was black folks or Muslims, they'd send in the militia to take them out. And that's just the reality. People cry and complain that we shouldn't say black lives matter, that all lives should matter. But the reality is, it is black lives that are being taken. It is Muslims now being in fearful of their life because of what they believe. And so I close with MLK's other saying, peace is not merely a distant goal that we seek, but a means by which we arrive at that goal. Tonight, we can rest easy that peace is beginning to happen through your vote tonight, and we'll take it to the nation. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend O'Neill. Thank you. Beautiful words. Thank you. Sabrina Banks Johnson. No? Terry Banks.
Hello, good evening. I would just like to thank Mayor Japlin, staff, chief staff, for being proactive. It's tough being here, but at the same time, sometimes you just got to put your personal feelings away and look at the big picture. And I just want to thank y'all for being proactive. Corey was my nephew, my favorite nephew, and this is my sister Sabrina, and we miss him very much. But at the same time, while we wait for answers, we will continue to work for change. Thank you.
Thank you. Derek Lecrae.
Good evening, everybody. To the mayor and council members, staff, and everybody. I just want to say I'm excited. I'm happy about the change. You know, I don't have an eloquent speech or anything at this particular time because I speak from the heart. And the truth of the matter is that we're going in the right direction. And I appreciate the hospitality and the accommodating meetings that we have had with Mayor Javelin, Mr. Ferris, Chief Stepp, Ms. Temple, and we also reached out to Mr. Russo at particular times with this. And we know that this is change for the nation, not just for the city of Palm Beach Gardens, but you are that stepping stone, that cornerstone for us to be able to take these initiatives across the county, throughout the state, and throughout the country. That's how important that this is. I believe that this is a God move. And we're sorry that Corey had to be the catalyst for the change that needs to take place nationally. It's important that we set a template and have a roadmap for everybody else to follow, that we can do this without violence. This has been a nonviolent movement. This has been a movement of spirituality, camaraderie, that we can talk. You know, it's nothing special about Derek McCray, Ray Whiteley, or Reverend O'Neill. And we just came in as concerned citizens for the community that we need to make change and that we went out on faith to see change take place. And through that faith, we were able to come up with these initiatives. I must commend Chief Stepp for him being as open and talking to us. You know, I thought something different when I came in, but once we sat down and talked, I seen a different person. The same thing with Ron. I thought something different, but once we sat down and talked, we were so far here, but when I talked to Mayor Javelin, we were all right here. So it was important that our differences wasn't that far apart. We just had to talk about it and see where we were and how we can come together and compromise and come up with something that makes community sense, law sense, legislative sense. And I think we were able to accomplish that by everybody being having a humble spirit, a spirit of not being adversarial. We didn't come in with that. We needed to see this. We needed this change, because if we would have came in fussing and fighting, it was got a little real in the field for a minute, but it wasn't where we couldn't sit down and we couldn't compromise and come up with initiatives that made sense. And all these initiatives make sense for us to follow, to take to the next city. And I think it will be respected because we had good people in the room in order to pull this off. So I want to say kudos to the city of Palm Beach Gardens for expediting the body cameras, for expediting the plain clothes assignment, for expediting the diversity training programs with bias-based testing, teaching us about the fair and impartial policing, about the new training centers that's going on. And I think that other cities should model this. You know, and it's unfortunate what happened to Corey, because Corey was a great guy. And I hurt every day just thinking that he lost his life behind an incident. If somebody just would have came up and said, hey, I'm the police, he might still be here today. But unfortunately, this has been happening all over the country, and Corey was the sacrificial lamb for these initiatives to move forward. And we want to thank Corey's family for supporting us coming in as a community to meet with you guys and help us set the boundaries that's going to move forward with the rest of these cities. So I just want to say thank you for your time, your hard work, and we know we got a couple more meetings to get to really tighten this all up, but we're very appreciative and we're thankful. Thank you.
Thank you, Derek. That's the rest. That's it. I have no more cards unless anyone else would like to speak from the public. Seeing none, I'm going to close this public hearing and bring it up here.
I have a question for the chief. Chief, you weren't able to check out, and this is something as part of the movement, what we're going to have to do. Remember, I had asked the question about whether there was going to be any credits with insurance, and I don't know that you were able to get an answer on that, but this is something that we need to approach insurance companies that write the liability coverage, because having body cameras provides evidence that would lessen the liability. That's part of what I think we need to make this to be as easy for other cities and the cost reduction and so forth. And I know they're going to be going to Tallahassee in a few weeks and try and get funding for this to be done in different cities in our state, which I think is good. I'd just like to make a comment here. I'd like to also thank the Clergy Alliance, Chief Stepp, the mayor, city staff. As you well know, the mayor was out of town, and I was invited by Mayor Masters to go to a rally, and I went down there and made certain commitments, and I said that, unfortunately, I'd love to bring Corey back, even though I didn't know him. And by the way, Derek, I heard every day for this, too, because it happened in our city. I didn't know the young man, but everything I've read and so forth about him, he was a great young man, and to lose him was just an injustice. But I said that night that I couldn't do anything to bring Corey back, but the only thing I could do is make sure his life didn't go in vain. And this is the beginning. I said that if policies were followed in this procedure, I mean, this terrible, tragic event, then we needed to change our policies. I know the chief strengthened the policies. We're doing body cameras. And I will tell you that this needs to be a model for other cities. If you would have asked me 2 years ago whether this needed to be done, I probably would have said no. There's no racial divide in our city. I don't see that. But yet this poor young man, okay, didn't feel safe in our city. And I guess that's a problem for me in that we have to make everybody feel safe in our city. And what we're doing here tonight is going to be a beginning. But as Mayor Masters said that night, this is a movement, and the movement has to go to other cities. We need to, and I'm willing to help in any way I can, to get other city leaders to recognize something that I probably wouldn't have recognized. But this needs to happen so that this event doesn't happen in another city. The one thing I do know, if this happened in the city of Palm Beach Gardens, this can happen anywhere. And, you know, I always say that God put us on this earth to accomplish something. Unfortunately, we all miss Corey. I didn't know him, but I miss him because of what I know of him now. And God put him here to help change things. And in his short life, if we take this and make this happen, then Corey will have accomplished more in his life than many other people will ever accomplish. And we owe it to him to do this. So that's all I have to say, and I'm willing to help you guys wherever you want to go, whatever cities, because they need to understand why this is important. So
thank you.
That's all I have to say. In fact, Mayor Masters just texted me, wanted to know how it went, so I guess I can let him know later. I couldn't text him back because I'm in the middle of it. So. And again, to the Banks family and the Jones family, again, I'm very sorry. Give my deepest, strongest condolences and respect. I mean, it's just a sad situation.
Yeah, but we've taken a sad situation, and hopefully we're moving it on to something even better.
Yes, yes.
I thank you for everybody. Well, I want to thank these gentlemen and ladies here tonight because when we first did meet, there was some tension, obviously. You know, neither of us knew what to expect, but it didn't take us long to become fast friends and co-workers in a mission that, frankly, is bigger than all of us. And as Joe said, I hope that just this is the beginning. Palm Beach Gardens has always been a leader in so many ways. We were thrust into this. It's not something we sought out. But we have a leader's mentality, and I hope that carries on to other cities in Palm Beach County, Broward County, Dade County, and all the counties in Florida and across the nation because, frankly, this is just a beginning. And so we thank you, Reverend Whiteley, O'Neill, Derek McCray, the Banks family, and gentlemen, thank you for standing up and talking on behalf of this ordinance. We truly appreciate your being here. We look forward to working with you long into the future to make all of this a reality everywhere. So thank you again. Anyone else would like to say? We're going to get on with voting for this, if we can get a motion.
I'd like to move Resolution 9-2015.
I'd like to second it.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Passes 5-0. Thank you so, so very much.
Thank you very much.
This is really a moment where people have gotten together and cooperated to create something, even out of a tragedy. And, you know, I'd really like to thank our police department, the members of the community, our staff, our city manager for keeping a level head, working together to make something. I realize we're on the first step, but I'm going to speak for my other council members. If you all need help with this, please, you know, we would be happy to relate our experiences and how well, you know, this has worked. And Derek, I'm going to disagree with you on something. I hope you don't mind. I think you all are very special.
Yeah, it is. It is. Thank you. Okay, we're going to move on to Ordinance 14. 2015. Clerk will read the title, please.
Ordinance 14-2015, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, rezoning certain real property within the corporate limits of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, consisting of one parcel of real property totaling 0.57 acres in size, more or less, located at the southeast corner of Military Trail and Mary Circle, providing that this parcel of real property, which is more particularly described herein, shall be assigned the City Zoning Designation of Plan Unit Development, PUD, overlay with an underlying zoning designation of professional office PO, providing that the zoning map at the City of Palm Beach Gardens be amended accordingly, providing a conflicts clause, a severability clause, an authority to codify, providing an effective date for other purposes. Resolution 65-2015 is a companion item to Ordinance 14-2015 and will require council action. Resolution 65-2015, a resolution of the City Council of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, approving the development of a new 3,560-square-foot office building. The subject site is located at the southeast corner of Military Trail and Mary Circle, as more particularly described herein, providing conditions of approval, providing waivers, providing an effective date for other purposes.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to open the public hearing. Declare any partes, ex partes?
None
for me. Do we need a presentation on this? This is second reading. Everybody okay with the?
Mr. Mayor, there have been no changes.
No changes
since first reading.
Are we okay?
I'd rather not give the Don hearing presentation tonight. Keep it short and simple.
We're the same way.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
As long as you don't lead off with "I'll be brief."
We have.
I'll
no
be
card.
Brief.
We
have. Oh no.
We have no cards on this. Anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing none, I'm going to close the public hearing and bring it back up for discussion or motion.
Move Ordinance 14-2015 for a second reading and adoption.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Passes 5-0.
Thank you.
Resolution 65. Can I get a motion on 65?
Oh, yeah.
Second. Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Passes 5-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ordinance 15. Clerk, will read the title, please.
Ordinance 15-2015, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, adopting an amendment to its comprehensive plan in accordance with the mandate set forth in Section 163.3177 Florida statutes, pursuant to a city-initiated amendment which provides for the annual update to the five-year capital improvement schedule within the capital improvements element, providing that the data as amended or revised shall be substituted for and replace the existing data in the capital improvements element, providing for transmittal to the State and Land Planning Agency for review, providing a conflicts clause, a severability clause, and authority to codify, providing an effective date and further purposes.
Thank you. So I'm opening a public hearing. Has anything changed since first reading?
No changes since first reading.
Do we need a presentation?
No.
No, okay. No cards. In that case, anyone wishing to speak? Seeing none, I'm going to close the public hearing, bring back up for discussion or motion.
Move Ordinance 15-2015. Sorry, I had to put my glasses on. On second reading and adoption.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Passes 5-0. Next is Resolution 1-2016, Taco Bell site plan.
Resolution 1-2016, a resolution of the City Council of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, approving a site plan amendment and major conditional use, providing for the demolition of the existing Taco Bell fast food restaurant on North Lake Commons, which is located on the south side of North Lake Boulevard, east of Interstate 95, as more particularly described herein, in order to construct a new 2,674 square foot fast food restaurant with drive through, providing conditions of approval, providing an effective date, and further purposes.
Thank you. I'll open the public hearing. Any ex partes?
None.
None. Okay, petition and presentation, please.
Please state that you were sworn in.
Tara Toto for the record, Core States, on behalf of Taco Bell, I was sworn in. Okay. Our project, Taco Bell, is located at an out parcel within the North Lake
Can you
Commons.
Speak up, please? Hard to hear you.
Oh, sorry.
There you go. Thanks.
The proposed proposed project is Taco Bell located at 3800 North Lake Boulevard. It's on the south side of North Lake Boulevard, just east of 95, in the North Lake Commons Shopping Center. The building has been located there for over 25 years. And we're proposing to demolish and redevelop the Taco Bell. The out parcel is approximately 1.06 acres, and it has a general commercial zoning with a compatible land use of commercial. The surrounding area is predominantly commercial. This is a street aerial and street view of the existing Taco Bell. It's located right at Sand Tree Drive and North Lake. Here's some images of the existing Taco Bell. As you can see, the style of the building is old with a mission style architecture and the traditional Taco Bell, older Taco Bell colors. Not currently consistent with the existing shopping center. The proposed shopping center, or the proposed Taco Bell layout is generally the same as what exists today with the building right in this location with the drive through here and parking in this area. We're eliminating some parking that's existing right here and reconfiguring the parking area here. We aren't doing anything to the ingress, egress, so the layout of the design will stay the same. The drive aisles are a little bit larger, and the parking terminals are larger, so this will allow the emergency vehicles to enter and exit the site easily. Overall, the proposed Taco Bell will offer a better circulation around the site. We'll also be, let me go back just a little bit. We won't be modifying the existing monument sign, but we will be adding a focal point and some landscaping with nice plantings, as well as this is the existing menu board. It's larger than what's allowed today, and we're going to be providing a conforming menu board, smaller in size, and also adding a focal point with landscaping there. Currently, there's a dumpster enclosure in this area. However, it doesn't meet the setback requirements today, so we're going to be relocating that just in the same area, but to meet the current code. We're also going to be replacing the existing light poles with conforming light poles and compatible light fixtures throughout the to match what was approved with the recent Joann Fabrics approval. The new Taco Bell architecture is a more modern style building than what exists today, and the colors are compatible with the shopping center. We're going to be having tower features. The mechanical equipment will be screened, awnings, and the roof line and roof color will be compatible with the existing shopping center. The back of house will be over here, and the service door and employee entrance is here. This is the west-facing facade. The cooler and freezer are here, and there's only internal access to that. This is the drive-through side of the building. You can see that the architectural features are throughout every facade. And the elevations provide depth and variation in massing by providing the towers, columns, and framing to the structure. We had received some recommendations by the PZAB board, which approved our project, and we work with staff to address their comments, and I think we achieved that. Here are the colors that are going to be on the building. The patina green, which matches the Joann Fabrics, and the more earth tone colors on the building, and darker accents. Some of the plantings in the foundation plantings and the focal points are going to be the Mediterranean fan palm, Spanish bayonet shrub, Mammy Croton, honeycut, and we're going to also have honeycut river rock, which will be around the foundation of the building. And this will provide a fire stop and lower maintenance. Overall, the project is a vast improvement from what it currently exists. As far as the architecture, compatibility, and circulation of the site. And we're going to be providing, in addition to the landscaping that's there now, we're going to be maintaining the buffers and enhancing the landscaping. And we have about 46% open space. So it'll be a nice finished product that the city will be proud of. And I wanted to thank staff, because they've been very, very supportive, particularly Joann. She's been excellent to work with, has helped me through the process, and is always is always available and very quick to respond to any questions we may have. So I just want to say thank you.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm signing stuff here, and I'm trying to do two things at once. Thank you. Thank you very much. We've all seen this presentation before by staff, so it's okay? It's okay. Okay with
staff,
you guys?
Just for the record, staff does recommend approval
okay.
of the project.
All right, great. Thank you. We have no cards.
Just two quick questions. Construction, not at night, right? During the day, construction will be going on? Because this is going to be a pretty quick turnaround. I would assume level and then build the suit pretty quickly.
Yes, the construction will have to occur within our city code of ordinances, which have limitations, so all construction will abide by those hours, which prohibits construction.
Okay. And any way we can talk to their neighbor, Arby's, to do the same thing, level the building and beautify that corner?
Yeah.
Because then that whole corner would be done. I mean,
trying to get the whole project.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I mean, yeah. You're going to have that one little sore spot, unfortunately, in the middle of the two new facilities. But anyway, it is what it is.
That's a good idea, Bert. Yeah.
Thanks.
Okay, there are no cards on this. This is a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak on this? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing, bring it up for a motion.
Move resolution number one, our first one, 2016.
I'll second that.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Passes 5-0. Next is ordinance 2, 2016.
Ordinance 2, 2016, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, amending the City of Palm Beach Gardens budget for the fiscal year beginning October 1, 2015 and ending September 30, 2016 inclusive, providing a conflicts clause, a severability clause, and authority to codify, providing an effective date and further purposes.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Open the public hearing, staff presentation.
Good evening. Alan. For the record, Alan Owens, Finance Administrator. Ordinance 2, 2016, our fiscal year 2015-16 budget amendments. These are the standard amendments that we do each year as we close out the previous year, move into the next year. The first area that we address are the carry forwards of unspent projects and purchase orders from the prior year, 2014-15, into this current year, 2015-16. Just to give you an idea of some of the significant projects that are being carried forward, no big surprises here. Everybody's aware of these. We have City Park expansion, about $1.9 million. The Golf Clubhouse, about $3.5 million. Both of those projects are being funded out of rec impact fees. We have also Fire Station Number 2, which is nearing completion, about just under $1.5 million. That's a general fund funded project. Police tactical training facility, just under $3 million. That's being accounted for in our police impact fund. We have around $517,000 for further enhancements to the municipal complex, the plaza area. That's a general fund project, monies that are being carried over in the general fund. We have about $593,000. Of improvements to Campus Drive. That's a road impact funded project. Our water road improvement projects, 40th Terrace, Sunset Drive, $447,000. There's a shot there. You can see a vast improvement being taken place in that area of the town. $286,000 in our gas tax fund being carried over for the stormwater refurbishment renovation program. We have $396,000 being carried forward for the bridge refurbishment project. We also have $400,000 that's being carried over for the Johnson Dairy Military Trail Improvements Project. We also, in the gas tax fund, are carrying over around $144,000 for FEC crossing maintenance. And lastly, we have about $144,000 in the art impact fund that's being carried over to complete the artistic bus shelter project. The second area that we address in these budget amendments is where we adjust our beginning budgeted fund balances to the actual ending fund balances as we close the books on the prior year. And just to hit some of the highlights there, our general fund budget stabilization reserve increased by about $1 million to about $3.1 million. Our reserve for infrastructure in the general fund increased about $2.4 million to $2.5 million. And our unassigned reserve, some people call it the rainy day fund, stays flat at about $23.1 million. Just one item to note as far as the budget stabilization reserve fund, that $3.1 million, we just had one item that was approved for the body cameras. We have another item, if that is approved also tonight, that reserve fund, the budget stabilization, would be back down to about where it was, about $2.1 million. So even after everything is approved, our total reserves in the general fund will be up by about $2.4 million, and that's in the reserve for infrastructure. And with that, staff recommends approval of Ordinance 2, 2016. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Right, thanks. Alan, any questions? Okay, this is a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Bring it back up for a motion.
Move Ordinance 2, 2016 on first reading.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Passes 5-0. Thank you. Thank you, Alan. Yeah, we're all a little loopy. Resolution 6, 2016.
Resolution 6, 2016, a resolution of the City Council of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, approving and ratifying a collective bargaining agreement and two memorandums of understanding with the professional firefighters and paramedics of Palm Beach County, Local 2928 IAFF Incorporated, employed by the city for fiscal years 2015-2016, 2016-2017, and 2017-2018, authorizing the mayor to execute said agreement, providing an effective date and further purposes.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. Cheryl Stewart, for the record. And with me is Chief Mike Southard with the fire department. The city's negotiating team and the union members with the IFF successfully reached a tentative agreement in October of 2015. The union voted in favor of ratification in November and December. The new contract provides for salary adjustments using the same process and approach that was used with the PBA. The salary adjustments for each employee were made utilizing the latest data as of September of 2015, contract data, and is in line with the comparable top fire departments throughout Palm Beach County and addresses compression. The total cost of salary increases over the 3 years of the contract is approximately $1.86 million. One of the key operational concerns was also addressed, which was to reduce the number of shift exchanges that employees could have between each other to provide greater continuity of command and have supervisors spend more time with their crews, training and keeping up with their skills, and also curtail some attendance concerns. As a result of the salary adjustments and resolving the management issues, a three-year contract was ratified by the union to be effective October 1st, 2015 through September 30th of 2018. Further on the next item would be on the agenda a resolution to amend the budget to allocate approximately $817,000 from the budget stabilization fund to cover the increase in personnel costs for the current fiscal year. Staff is recommending approval.
Thank you, Cheryl. This is a public hearing. I'm going to open the public hearing. I didn't do that before, but anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing none, can I close the public hearing? Bring it up for a discussion?
Wait a minute, I just want to know where all the yellow shirts are tonight.
Yeah, where are they tonight?
We're going to get him here the next meeting. We had a little fun with him.
I understand.
When will your fire station be done? I'm sorry, I forgot to ask that last one.
We're shooting for the first week of February.
That close.
We hope to do a dedication the second week. So
I didn't know we were that close.
Yeah,
it's now starting
to really take off. So we're inside, obviously. We've got the power on, that sort of thing. So it's really taking shape.
Okay, great. Thank you.
It looks great. Really.
Resolution 6. And I'll second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thanks for your work, Cheryl.
Aye. Passes 5-0. Okay. Resolution 8, 2016.
Resolution 8, 2016, a resolution of the City Council of the City of Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, amending the City of Palm Beach Gardens budget for the fiscal year beginning October 1, 2015 and ending September 30, 2016, inclusive by approving the transfer of funds pursuant to Section 2-293 Appropriations Code of Ordinances to fund the cost of the collective bargaining agreement with the professional firefighters and paramedics of Palm Beach County, Local 2928 IAFF Incorporated, for the fiscal year ending September 30, 2016, providing an effective date and for other purposes.
This is a public hearing. I'm going to open the public hearing. Staff presentation? Nothing? Nothing. Anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing none, close the public hearing. Bring it back up for a motion. Someone want to make a resolution 8, 2016 motion?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
It passes 5-0.
Okay.
I think we've reached the end. Wow. You have something? City attorney's report. Look, we don't usually have a city attorney's report.
I know, there's usually nothing under it, and I guarantee I can get you out of here in 90 seconds or less. I just saw the council, I had informed all of you, you all know that the case of D&G Limited versus Palm Beach Gardens, that was the Palm Beach Puppies case at the down here at our Publix Plaza. We had our hearing for summary judgment on that case over the issues of them seeking injunctive relief. They made an equal protection claim under the Florida Constitution, a substantive due process claim, and they claimed equitable estoppel, that we should have been equitably estopped. They had vested rights. This was a case of first impression under Florida state law and the Florida Constitution. I'm very proud and happy to report to you that we won. Judge Sasser granted summary judgment in favor of the City of Palm Beach Gardens on the grounds of the regarding the substantive due process claim as well as the equitable estoppel claim. Apparently, the arguments that we made in our brief were sound enough that when they walked into the hearing, the plaintiff conceded the equal protection argument as well as the injunctive relief argument. So it's a big win for the City of Palm Beach Gardens and all municipalities across the state that now want to adopt an ordinance similar to the one that you so wisely adopted. And on December 23rd, with the assistance of our police department, thank you, Chief Stepp, and all the officers involved, the puppy store closed its doors in Palm Beach Gardens for good.
Yay. Yeah. Thank you, Max. Great job, Max.
Thank you.
And all the puppies in the world, thank you. If everybody, that's puppy power, right? And if everybody, every other city passed an ordinance like this, maybe we'd stop all of those puppy mills. Thank you. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor? Aye. Thank you, everybody. Our first back-to-back in a long time, and we got it done.